Welcome everybody to another episode of Clutter's Coalition, the show that's still haunted by DC's New 52. I am one of your hosts, Christian Bean, and here with me is the beautiful, the wonderful, the man that is still preparing the lynching of Dan Didio, Mario Bennese.
Good evening.
This is this episode before Halloween, the best holiday.
I was summoning my inner Alfred Hitchcock for that.
You didn't do very good.
It wasn't very good, no, but I tried.
Yeah. No. You don't even get the trying on that one. I'm sorry.
Rats.
So how was your week?
That's a good question. That's a very good question.
We're all waiting in anticipation.
Well, it would have been fine, except for everything that led up to today.
I'm literally clenching right now.
Are you really?
Get onto it. No, I'm not. I continue though.
Oh, okay. So, I have this bad habit of not sleeping. Mostly because I'm not tired, mostly because I have a terrible sleep schedule. It's just a combination of the two.
Oh, yeah, you do. And it's kind of my fault.
Yeah, it's a combination of the two, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so, I work on Wednesdays. Now, I happen to have been primary RA on duty this week, meaning that I get all the calls.
Okay.
That's fine, right?
Mm-hmm.
Since we've implemented new policies, I don't get calls anymore, so I don't have to go take care of lockouts when kids get locked out of the room, which is fine. I don't get any calls unless something happens.
I don't know. I think it kind of sucks because, you know, you usually cut those kids a pretty nice break. Like, you weren't too harsh on them.
Yeah, well, unless they're jerks to me, I make sure that, you know, they're getting charged. But if it's something small like, hey, you know, this like a very specific circumstance where it's like, yeah, it's really not your fault,
mm-hmm.
then yeah, I'll be cool to them. But I was working primary this week, which isn't bad.
Okay.
I don't get any calls, which is great. Nothing has ever happened really any time that I've been working.
That's nice.
Like on those days for the past 2 years that I've been doing this job. So that gave me time to do my episode for my other show.
I've never held a job for 2 years. I usually quit within a year. For school or whatever. Or I'm just done with the garbage.
But I couldn't sleep from like 11-ish or 10:30-ish to like 5 or 6 in the morning. So I'm like, you know what? I'm going to take this time. I got a busy weekend coming up. I'm just going to take this time and record my other podcast Up and Away.
Mm-hmm.
So I did that at like 3 in the morning. I finished at like 3 in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And I'm like, all right, well, I should probably get to bed now. 6 o'clock rolls around.
Sleep?
Yeah, I know. 6 o'clock rolls around.
Mm-mm.
Duty phone rings.
Heh,
RA and duty, this is Mario. How may I help you? Hey, I just wanted to make sure that you were coming down to work the desk shift from 6 to 9. Nobody's scheduled. Yeah, no, because remember that policy they... Let me preface this. Okay, so there are two types of people that work the desk. There are RAs, which is what I am, and then there is DAs, which are desk assistants. And they are hired exclusively to sit at the desk and be at that desk for a certain amount of time. They are paid hourly. They have lost a lot of people because the person in charge of the DAs, and I'm going to straight up call him out on this, is a terrible, terrible supervisor. He does not update the schedule. He does not update the contact information. He has DAs that do not show up to their shifts until 3 hours after that shift has ended.
I know you're pretty salty about that one.
Oh, I am very salty. I had to sit there. My shift started. I had a shift that started at 9 and went to 1 in the morning, right?
Mm-hmm.
I did not get to leave until 3 in the morning when I decided, you know what? Screw this. I'm shutting the desk down. I got a class in the morning.
Hey, man, you don't get paid any extra for those 3 hours.
That's the thing.
I told you that night you should have left earlier.
That's the thing. I don't get paid extra for this. And this is what... I wouldn't mind sitting 6 to 9 in the morning if I were getting paid hourly. But I do not get paid hourly because that is not my job. And while I technically do have to work at the desk as an RA, this is not my job. My job is not to sit there from 6 in the morning to 9 in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
So I was going... until at least 3 in the afternoon on 3 hours of sleep. That was 17 hours I was consecutively awake. 17 hours.
I'm sorry. I know I am. That really sucks. The look he gave me was just like, you're not screwing me, right? This is real emotions you're feeling? I'm like, yes.
Oh, God. I was so done.
Did you take a nap?
Yeah, I took a nap.
Oh, that's good.
It was like a 2-hour nap because that's apparently all I need to recover from, you know, sleep deprivation. Because that's how that works.
Hey, man, it could be worse. A buddy of mine, he goes days without sleep. It's a That gets worrisome. He's got insomnia problems.
I like sleeping, though.
So do I. I think most people do. Anything else happening this week?
My mom's coming to visit on Saturday.
That's right. She is coming to visit. So. She's coming Saturday in the morning or Saturday night?
Saturday in the morning?
Are you still going to come? We're having a Halloween party.
Yeah, I'm still going to go to that. I already told her about that. I'm like, yeah, I just, you know, my buddies are having a Halloween party, and I've already sunk a lot of money into this costume, and it'd kind of be a waste.
He's going as David Bowie.
Yeah.
There will be pictures on that website. He doesn't think there's going to be, but I'm going to take pictures of him in drag. It's going to be beautiful.
Yeah, no, I bought a blouse, I bought some women's boots, and I will look fabulous.
Dude, you know what I told you I almost went as?
What?
I almost went as 11 from Stranger Things. It was going to be great. But instead I'm going to be doing, my girlfriend's found this really, really, you were there for this really, really cute, dress that looks like something a, ringleader would wear at a circus. So I'm going to go as a ringleader with her and we'll be ringleaders together. I kind of wish it was a flying grace in this, but unfortunately we do not have a child we can kidnap. My little brother's in St. Pete, which is sad. And also making the flying grace himself would be kind of difficult.
Yeah.
Especially if it's the 70s one.
Oh, yes.
Sweet Jesus. Those are flamboyant.
I'm still really surprised that we had to drive all the way to the next town over to find a Goodwill that actually had affordable stuff.
Yeah, it's weird when the Goodwill in your city is more expensive than some department stores. I'm just like, this isn't Goodwill. There's no Goodwill here.
Only pockets full of lies.
Oh, yeah. Honestly, with me, there's nothing been going on.
No?
No. It's been a slow week. I got a couple papers back. C's, which is fine. He graded me pretty... He was pretty nice about the grading, because after reading through and looking at his criticisms, those papers were garbage. But I see what he wants now, and I get it. I still completely disagree with the idea that a paper about opinions, you should have to sort facts, use sources when the opinion is about your particular view of a movie. I'm like, no. That's okay. I like the teacher a lot. I get what he's trying to do. He wants to make sure we're reading the articles. He wants to make sure we're informed and we fully understand what we're talking about, which I can respect. What can you do?
Oh, that reminds me. Okay. So I had to write a one-page response paper for Italian-American cinema, right?
Oh, boy.
Now, I had taken, like I had shut my eyes for 10 minutes. That turned into, like, 20 minutes. So that's not really a nap because I didn't get into REM sleep, really.
You didn't snore in class like one guy in my class does all the time.
Oh, God, there was a kid that was snoring in one of my classes. He's a big guy. He's just using his chest as, like, a pillow.
Wait. Does he have, like, a neck beard?
No. Does he?
Shorter hair, big guy, wears a Cartman shirt sometimes?
No.
Oh, okay.
No.
So we're talking about the same guy. He's constantly sleeping in my glasses. Out like a light.
But anyway, I had to write this paper, and I'm like, all right, well, I'm going to keep myself awake for a little bit because this isn't going to take me very long.
Yeah.
It's one page. I'll just watch a little bit of Angry Video Game Nerd. And that nap rolls around, like that 10-minute nap.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, crap. It's 1:39. I have class at 2 o'clock. I need to write this paper and print it out and get over to my class.
Good man. Do tomorrow.
So I start writing it, and then I start to drift, and my finger just stays on the K. There's like 5 lines of K. I'm like, whoa, that's not a paper. So I was like 5 minutes late to my class.
But you finished the paper?
Yeah.
Okay. Woo, that was worrisome.
Yeah.
Was it double spaced?
Yeah.
Oh, that's not that bad.
Yeah, that's why.
It's like half a page.
Yeah, that's why I don't worry about it, because it's...
It's like, what, 500 words?
Yeah, something like that.
Not even that.
Just fell asleep on the K, but...
All right, my man. I think it's time for us to get to the news. First up to bat, happy 40th birthday to Ryan Reynolds.
The greatest Green Lantern ever.
I will kill you.
Please don't.
I did like his Green Lantern, though. I think he put a pretty good Hal Jordan. The movie's problems was not his. Happy birthday, man. You're very talented. I'm happy to hear that you now have a career that's actually worth anything.
Yeah. What was that one remake that he was in that was terrible? That horror film.
Oh, I don't remember what it was called. But he's been in a bunch of horrible stuff before Deadpool. Like, a lot of bad things. He was really known for his rom-coms.
Yeah.
Which weren't very romantic nor comedic, in my personal opinion. I don't like rom-coms, so that's my whole thing. But happy birthday, man. Hope you have a nice... Hope you enjoy
it. The Amityville Horror.
Amityville Horror. That's right. That movie was trash. So we're going to get right into the news. First up, AT&T buys Time Warner for $85.4 billion. That's a lot of money.
That is.
That's a lot of clams.
Yeah.
So what do you think? This is pretty big news with, you know, DC Entertainment's owned by Time Warner, and so is HBO. So I wonder where that's going to go for them. I don't really know what type of business AT&T is.
I mean, I know they deal with phones. I just don't know how they run their business. That's my thing. Same. It could be a good thing. It could be a bad thing. And I'm hoping it's a good thing.
They could be just a cash cow that Time Warner works under.
Yeah.
Well, like, hey, we back all your stuff. Hey. I mean, it's not the big news like the Marvel Disney buyout or the Disney Marvel buyout, the Disney LucasArts buyout, or anything that Disney buys out, because when they buy things, they actually put things in place and they make sure it's quality. Like where they completely stripped LucasArts when they bought that. They tore them apart. They redid the entire canon, which was for the better because the canon didn't make any sense to begin with. Excuse me. I have a friend right now who's literally sitting on his computer yelling at me because he loves old Star Wars canon. And though I like old Star Wars canon,
I like it too, but it was a little bit messy in some places.
Everywhere. Nothing fit. It was weird.
See, my biggest thing with this is that it's such a weird company to buy out such a huge company.
It is.
It's like McDonald's buying out Universal.
Though I don't think that'd be a bad idea, because I'd be butt up loving it. Don't hurt me, I bruise easy. Speaking of weird news, Incredibles 2 has moved up from 2019 to June 15th, 2018. Wow, that was weird.
Oh, I must have missed that one.
Toy Story 4 was pushed back to June 21st, 2019. That's strange. I wonder what that means. The Incredibles 2 being moved up, I could really care less about, because honestly, it's such a long time since the last Incredibles movie.
Yeah.
And such a long time. Though I want to see it, that period to where I really, really wanted it has flown the coop.
Yeah.
And Toy Story 4, I don't think really anybody wanted. They did say if they had a good story, they wanted it back, they were going to do it. Like, it was only going to happen if they had a really, really good script, which I respect. It means they have something that they really like. But
Pixar and sequels have not been going well
Toy Story 2,
lately.
Toy Story 3.
No, I'm talking like Cars 2 and...
That's fair. That's a fair...
Recently, they haven't been impressing me as much as they used to.
Inside Out.
Yeah, you have Inside Out, but for every Inside Out, you got a Cars 2 and a Cars and the Good Dinosaur.
I mean, really, the only few flops they really had were Cars 2, Cars 3, and the Good Dinosaur. Those are the only three movies I really thought were bad. I just didn't... I personally didn't prefer Cars. I didn't enjoy it, but I saw the value in it for people that did. I understood the audience it was aiming toward, and good for them. You know, they found an audience that liked it.
It was made to
Cars 2
sell
was
toys.
Bad. I didn't like Cars 1, but I can see that it was quality. Cars 2 was bad, and Cars 3
was disgusting.
It was made
to sell toys.
Yeah.
Toys. Cars 3 hasn't come out yet, though, has it?
I thought it did.
No, I don't think so.
Was that the spy one?
No, Cars 2 is the spy one.
Oh. Wow. I don't pay attention to these series at all. You heard about the spin-off planes?
Was there God.
Was it even made by them?
I think so.
No, it wasn't made by
them. No. That was a brand of Disney animation that they
did. Yeah,
it
wasn't made by them.
But it was a spin-off.
It was a spin-off.
I'm telling you, man. The next one they should make is called Automobiles, and they should put them all in a box set called Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. Wait, no. Let's do it. The next one, Trains, and have...
Planes, trains, and automobiles.
I botched that.
Wow, that was a funny joke you ruined.
I really did ruin that.
Honestly, I'm happy to see Incredibles 2. I do feel that time frame is closed. Like, see, now I'm just seeing because I'm curious what they're going to do with
it. That's the only reason I'm seeing it. Because I love Toy Story. I grew up on that movie. That was my movie.
And Toy Story 2 and Toy Story 3 are genuinely good films.
Those movies were my movies growing up.
Toy Story 3, the movie that didn't come out that long ago?
Well, no, like Toy Story 1 and 2. Those were my movies that growing up. And Toy Story 3 was like the perfect closure to that era.
I know Toy Story 4 has...
Because it came out right as I was about to go to college. Mm-hmm. That's the thing. Toy Story 4,
I don't mind it because they haven't... With the Toy Story series, they haven't delivered anything but quality. Like even the show they made about the Toy Story series is, well, the Buzz Lightyear like little verse. That was even great.
Oh, Buzz Lightyear Star Command?
Yeah, that was even great.
That was pretty rad.
So I'm happy to see where that goes.
Buzz Lightyear bumming around with a robot?
Branching out, keeping on the Disney news, but getting off the weird, Donald Glover is cast as young Lando Calrissian in the Han Solo Star Wars movie coming out in December 2018.
You just wrinkled my brain, yo.
Oh, yes! I love Donald Glover.
I know. I love him a lot.
Yeah, what was the... Wow.
He was Troy in Community.
That's right. That's when I first saw him was in Community, because you introduced me to Community, and I thank you every day, because that show makes me smile every time.
Han and Lando in the morning.
I'm happy to see where that goes. Benny's a great actor. He's got a lot of charisma. He's very talented. He's very funny.
His stand-up specials are hilarious.
Oh, stand-up specials are the best. I want to see him play Suave, though. That's what I find interesting.
I think he can do it.
I think he can, too. But we haven't seen it before. And so it's the Suave kind of very bachelor-esque character. I'm curious to see where that goes. He might even get drops that he is Finn's son. Finn's dad. I kind of want him to be Finn's dad. I think out of all the new cast that I could see being the child of a previous, it should be Finn. I like that Poe isn't. I don't want Rey to be related to him, but I think that's a stupid idea. I think her being an original character is great. But I want Finn to be. I think that would be interesting to at least give Lando some really interesting character, like interesting end to his story, because he wasn't in the new one at all. And you would think Lando Calrissian would be. He'd be a major player.
He destroyed the second Death Star.
Makes you wonder, doesn't it?
What you doing there, Lando?
I think he was taken out for a reason. I'm curious what that reason is. It's a great casting. I personally can't think of anybody else that would fit that role. Yeah,
he looks the part too.
He does. He's handsome.
Now, if only we could get Chris Pratt to play young Han Solo.
We got a young Han Solo, and I like the kid. He looks cool. But I want
Chris
Pratt.
Oh, we did get that, didn't we?
Yeah, we did.
I forgot about that.
I want Chris Pratt. I'm still holding that.
Maybe young Indy.
Speaking of nostalgia, but something that no one really cares about, Knight Rider series is coming to Machinima in 2017. The Fast and Furious director Justin Lin is to direct the series.
Okay. Didn't they already try this?
Yeah.
They tried it like 5 years back, and it was mediocre at best.
It's the most outdated thing to do, and when it came out, it wasn't that big of a deal. It's got this like cult following.
See, Knight Rider's kind of cool, but it's playing on the nostalgia thing. Oh, you remember this.
It's the Evil Dead thing. Again. Yeah. Like, I like Ash versus the Evil Dead, but when that was announced, that was very like, hey, you like Evil Dead 2, right? And then like, there's half people going, oh my god! And the rest of the people are like, what? Because Evil Dead 2 was not that major of a thing when it, you know, first came out. Was not that major of a thing throughout its, like, I guess, existence. And Ash versus the Evil Dead has been the one thing that really pushed it back into kind of relevancy, which is cool because I love Evil Dead and Evil Dead 2. I love Evil Dead and Evil Dead 2. It's awesome. But I love Evil Dead 2 because it's so funny. So freaking funny. I think it's weird. I don't see the point behind it, honestly.
Yeah. It's a thing.
Speaking of things I really don't care to have, Uncharted movie gets Stranger Things director Sean Levy after it's their first director left, apparently due to creative differences.
I have a thing with video game movies. Now, you can have some that are really, really cool, right? Mm-hmm. It's the same thing with comic book movies. Like, I get it. It's representation in other media. And mm-hmm. I totally get it. People that have been fans of these games for years want to see something that they love on the big screen. Mm-hmm. That's fine. But for comic books, you can tell a story. For video games...
I think you have a
premise that you have to stick heavily to.
I think what you're trying to get at is that comic books is a storytelling medium.
Yes.
It is there to tell a story. Video games, yes, there's story and that's nice, but really video games isn't the strongest storytelling medium. Video games shines in its gameplay.
Yes.
That's what makes video games a unique form of art.
And even if they are story-based. Yeah, even if they're story-based.
There's still uniqueness and mechanics to make them interesting.
Why would I go watch a movie that might be bad if I can just go play the video game?
My problem with video games based off movies based off video games is that It always tries to do the direct translation, which I feel for video games isn't necessarily the best idea.
It's not interesting.
Because
we've seen it before.
Not even that. Well, we can say that for comics. Because comics do direct translation.
Yeah, they do that a lot too, and they don't get away with it.
The argument comes down to what makes video games fun and interesting is when you play the game, the gameplay. That's what makes it interesting. And you got like 40 hours of stuff happening. You can't fit all 40 of those hours into a 2.5 hour, that's being like generous, experience. I don't think this is really a point behind that. My thing is that when you make a video, when you make a movie based off a video game, I like what Assassin's Creed did. Though I don't think the Assassin's Creed movies are very good. I've got a bunch of reasons why I can sit for hours. I think that Assassin's Creed did the right thing. They branched off from the main story and went to something else, to another corner of the market. It's sort of like how we're getting a Gears of War movie. I don't want a movie based off the Gears of War games. I want a movie within the Gears of War universe branching somewhere else. If they were to Dead Space, I wouldn't want Isaac Clarke. I want a new main character doing something new somewhere else, something interesting. Because that's the cool thing about video games, which I feel in comics, it's there. But I think games are stronger, is that games build a very unique universe. Because games are long and be huge, which allows them the ability to grow this very unique lore and whatnot. It's how games work allows it to be expansive. I want to see a Fallout. I would love to see a Fallout movie, but I wouldn't want to see it in the Fallout universe.
No,
not universe. Within the Fallout games, I want to see it in a new city, and talking about that city, that'd be cool. I would love to see an Elder Scrolls movie, but not set in any of the games. Maybe set in one of the areas, but not like away somewhere. That's where video games shine. If you want to make a movie based on a video game, you can't make a direct translation. It doesn't work. It just
because won't, it, then it just it becomes will, a corporate let's yeah, play.
It will literally. It's a corporate let's. it's a man-made let's play. It will never work because you'll never get the same experience. So you have to be able to branch off of that. Now, there's always going to be a challenge. People watch it's like, oh, this is cool. I wish this was a game. I think that it's a little easier if it's not directly translated. But then there comes a challenge of how can I uniquely represent the game's feeling. I think, again, Assassin's Creed movie, as much as I don't think it's going to be very good, I think it does that. There's a lot of feeling I get from that movie. And I'm like, wow, this feels like the game.
Yeah.
Does that mean that when it comes out, it's going to be incomplete and we have to wait for the updated version for it to be better? I don't know, because that's exactly what the games do, every single one of them.
Regardless of how I think the movie's going to do, it does look a lot like the game, and I really appreciate that.
It has the same feeling with a new story, and that's where I think the good thing is. I think that studios need to realize that to make a good movie based off a video game, you have to stray away from the main story and go to something side. It's just, it's much better, because you're already going to... Same thing with comics. How do you make a good comic book movie? You take the comic books, you keep the characterizations the same, you make a good movie. Comic book fans will go because they want to see this movie with their favorite character, and everyone else will go because it's a good movie. It's not a hard thing to figure out. Same thing with video games based off movies based off video games. Gamers don't care if their main character's in it. Some do. Good for them. I can see how they feel. But what we want to see is we want to see the world come to life.
A big part of video games is the world. A lot of like open world stuff is what really drives these games.
You have control. You have the ability to do things. You have you can do all the you can move around. It's your feeling, your experience. So give the gamers a new experience they haven't had before from the games. I think we'd be remiss to not mention Warcraft, which I feel is a good way of doing it. But I feel my biggest problem with Warcraft is a little slow. It's a bunch of action, but the story's a little slow. And as cool as it is, it's very like, if you're a Warcraft fan, you're getting the better experience. Yeah. You just are. Like, you can not be a fan, you'll enjoy it 100%. But if you're a fan of World of Warcraft, there's so many little tidbits that most people be like, what? The people who play the games be like, oh, I get that. That's cool. Oh, that's cool. That's cool. But they don't really do anything with it. And that's a big complaint on my part, but it's not a big deal. All right, guys. Getting on to some more interesting news, but still keeping on the whole loss of director thing, Deadpool 2 is to lose its director, Tim Miller, due to creative differences with Ryan Reynolds where the sequel should go. I don't know what that means, honestly.
Neither do I.
The most known factor is the casting of Cable, and I wonder why. Did someone want an Arnold Schwarzenegger? Someone want an Arnold Schwarzenegger? You can see it
please,
now.
Please, please.
Someone wanted the Schwarzenegger.
Please have Arnold be...
Arnold
be Cable.
Deadpool. Wilson. Wilson, we have to save the future.
Put that cookie down.
Put that cookie down. Oh my god.
Stepping aside from our terrible Schwarzenegger impressions for a moment, back to the news.
I don't know. There's a lot of things. There's a lot of things to be said about it, but it's one of those weird situations to where you have to ask yourself, what made the Deadpool movie good? Was it Tim Miller's directing, or was it Ryan Reynolds' performance?
Or the writing.
Or the writing. And then again, a lot of that was heavily controlled by Ryan Reynolds himself. He was a big part of the movie. It's one of those moments to where the actor had a lot more control over the film than any actor does. Because for those of you who don't know, in the film industry, actors have little to no control over their character. Most good directors will always take the actor's ideas into consideration.
Yeah, like, because, oh, I don't think my character would do this or
because
that.
It's just disrespectful. But as it's difficult for most film majors to kind of comprehend when they first get in, is that if you're an actor, you're basically useless.
You're the director's pawn.
You're there to give the director what he wants, and that's all you're there for. Now, a good actor will always give opinions, and a good director will always listen to those opinions, but that doesn't always happen. So could this just be an argument between actor and director? Actor wanted to do one thing with the series, director wanted to do something else. They're both fans, they're both kind of bashing heads. I wonder what it means, because obviously Tim Miller's left, because we couldn't not have Ryan Reynolds as Deadpool. Now, it would be hilarious if we didn't have Ryan Reynolds as Deadpool, because that
and then
next
they
movie,
make a joke about
they would
it.
Make a joke about it in the next movie.
What, you couldn't afford Ryan Reynolds?
what was that movie? oh my god, the joke you're getting on. What's a joke from? Gosh, it's gonna kill me. George the Jungle.
Oh,
George
the
Jungle 2. Studio is too cheap to hire. What was the actor's name? What was his best?
Well, you guess too cheap to hire the rest of the X-Men?
Yeah. It's almost like the studio couldn't afford any other X-Men. I love that movie so much. At least we kept the writers from what I understand. And that's what's really important, because those writers are god tier. Continuing on the X-Men news, Cable was supposed to get a solo comic series in the X-Men Resurrection line coming in spring 2017. I still hate that name. Who cares? Cable's more interesting with Deadpool. He's not very interesting by himself. And this is coming from someone who actually likes Cable. I think he's a cool character with Deadpool. With other people. He's cool with other people. He's cool when he's a book with somebody else that they're co-starring in it. I don't really care about Cable by himself. It just sounds boring concept for me.
It doesn't really have anything really to do with me, it doesn't really resonate with me at all, mostly because I'm not a big X-Men guy, and
neither am I.
I'm not too...
I'm very selective which X-Men I actually really
like. I'm not too into Cable either. I don't know, it just screams try-hard 90s.
It's also to Deadpool when he first came out.
Oh, so did... Oh, definitely Deadpool.
But, I mean, now it's different. I don't know.
I'm sure they're compelling characters and all, it's just not my cup of tea.
I guess we'll see where it goes, and that's what matters, is that... Could this resurrection event be good?
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah, it could be.
I doubt it. I mean, if I'm being honest, I doubt it. Because this is Marvel. They haven't done anything actually good. It's been a while. A little upsetting. Sorry, guys. Sorry, Marvel fans. I love them too, but you can love something but still criticize it.
That's how Christian... That's how Christian talks to me. He criticizes me.
Wow. Now one's going to think we have an abusive relationship.
Don't we already?
A little bit, yeah.
Aren't we being honest with ourselves?
Yeah, a little bit. All right. last up is something that we wanted to bring up. Steve Dillon, the acclaimed artist from the Preacher books, has passed away at the age of 54 on October 22nd. Dillon was considered a prodigy for his work. He started at the age of 16. Just think about that. 16. What were we doing at 16? Things we're not going to discuss in this show because we try to keep it PG.
Yeah.
His first thing he did was the Hulk Weekly for Marvel UK. That's awesome. And then in the 90s, he worked on some amazing things. Like he worked on Hellblazer. And then, of course, in 1995, he did the Preacher series, which he won awards for. This is the same guy that went into multiple successful Punisher series in the 2000s. He drew then he started drawing the Marvel Now Thunderbolts, which I didn't read, and I started to look up for this, and God, it was amazingly beautiful art. It's It's a shame, man. We really lost a very talented artist. Honestly, a prodigy. He was a prodigy. You know,
dude could draw.
Yeah, it started so young. It's such an incredible story. To show that someone
16.
Yeah, it's amazing. 16.
I was building a pool to put my tears in at that age. The tears from my internal
I was trying to start a Let's Play channel at that age. That went over horribly.
And here's this guy. He just starts drawing for Marvel. And
yeah.
He's great.
Yeah, he's amazing. Rest in peace, man. You're going to be severely and sorely missed. I regret that I was never able to get you to sign my long box. For those of you who don't know, I have a long box I'm trying to get a bunch of comic creators to sign. And he was definitely one of them I wanted. And I regret not getting that now.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Off from the depressing news. So, guys, now on to our collection. Mario?
All right, so we're going to start off with the stuff that's not highlighted, as we do always, every week, because that's how we roll. Starting off is Batgirl number 4, written by Hope Larson and art by Raphael Albuquerque.
I liked it. I like this line. I think it's really well drawn. There's a couple of really emotional moments, but it's with a character I really don't care much about. So it's with her, like, best friend character. I don't really care much about him, personally. There's a couple of emotional moments, and it's fine. It's good. There's not much really to say about it, honestly. It's a good line. It's a good Batgirl line. Solid. Her last one was pretty good, too, except for a couple of, like, stupid, like, this is obviously connecting to millennials kind of bit they were doing for a while. It was frustrating, but what can you do? But I like it. It's good.
That's good. Mm-hmm. Next up, Batman Beyond number 1, written by Dan Jurgens and art by Bernard Chang. I liked it.
I like where it's going. I like what it's doing.
It was a setup issue.
It was a setup issue.
Which is
was.
Fine.
But the ending of this book was awesome.
I'm like, oh,
it was
what?
So cool.
What?
We actually got to see Batman get beat up on a little bit and have to run away. It was kind of cool. It's obviously not Bruce Wayne Batman. It's Terry McGinnis' yeah. Batman, which in some ways is honestly superior for some key things. Like, he's not a whiny douchebag. I love Bruce Wayne. He's my favorite
superhero. Kind of curmudgeonly.
He's kind of a douche. A little bit. Terry McGinnis is really cool. He's a cool character.
I like him a lot.
I do too. I love Terry.
I like the art in this too.
Oh, it's pretty, man.
I wish it
Chang
weren't.
Chang does a great job.
I wish it weren't a monthly book.
Same here, man. I want this bi-weekly. But some of the books that are like bi-weekly, I'd rather have monthly. And some of the monthly, I'd rather have bi-weekly. And it kind of hurts me a little bit.
There's not really that much to really talk about this because nothing really.
It's good.
It's hard
to do it because the ending's a super big spoiler. What's going to happen next? But basically, he goes against the entire V of Joker Town.
Yeah,
and that plays out exactly as you would expect.
The Jokers.
The Jokers.
With the backwards.
With the Z.
It's a Z.
Continue.
Next up, Blue Beetle number 2, written by Keith Giffen and art by Scott Collins.
It's fun.
I liked it.
Yeah, it's good.
It's getting better. We're actually starting to develop a plot.
Finally, after the Rebirth one-shot, the first issue, now the second issue, we finally started getting plot.
And it's not that they were bad. It's just that the first one, the Rebirth issue, was what was going on at the time of the DC Rebirth one-shot, like the actual universe one. That was set up because we have Dr. Fate come in and it's like, hey, you guys are actually messing with magic. Okay, cool. When do we get to mess with the magic now? Where? When?
Yeah.
And it's not that they were bad, it's just it was kind of vanilla villain of the week kind of thing.
Yeah, which is not a horrible thing. It's just I'm glad we're starting to get somewhere now.
Yeah.
It's a lot of setup and the setup is worth it because now when they are pulling some emotional cues, I'm like, oh okay, I can hang them.
I know. There's a bit at the end
that was really cool with
him and his mom.
It was so sweet.
And it hit a little close to home. Because mm-hmm. I'm like, I've had arguments like that where we just hug it out.
It's really sweet, honestly.
And I genuinely laughed at the Blue Beagle thing.
Yeah, the Blue Beagle? What are you, the Blue Beagle?
Beetle.
Just the look on his face was just pure anger, and I just loved it.
There's a moment where he looks at the camera, or like what would, I guess, be the camera if this were a movie.
Yeah.
He's like done. So done.
It's pretty great.
Next up, Deathstroke number 5, written by Christopher Priest and art by Joe Bennett.
I love Robin, man. Damien is such a little turd. He's sitting there just ripping into Deathstroke. I mean, ripping into him. It's the funniest thing. Just belittling him in every way possible. And Deathstroke's trying to belittle Robin. You think it's working in the end,
nope.
You realize, nah. It's,
nope.
It's Robin, man. Calm down. It was kind of cool to see Batman and Deathstroke's daughter work together a little bit. That was pretty cool. And how that kind of played out was really fascinating. the ending, though, man, that ending was a... Like, it kind of built up to this. When you got there, like, whoa, holy... You find out who the villain is. You find out who took the hit out on his daughter. And God, is it good.
Now, is this a bi-weekly book or a monthly?
Yes, bi-weekly book.
Okay.
I'm excited for the next... I'm actually excited for the next Deathstroke, which I haven't been for the last few. I'm only been... I was keeping going because I wanted to try it out, and then I was doing it because Batman's in it, and now because I'm actually genuinely excited. I'm excited to see where the story goes.
I'm only
also picking... this issue is hilarious.
I'm going to pick up the issue or two where Superman shows up because it's been teased in the solicits that he shows up.
I'm excited.
I have low standards. Next up, Spider-Man Deadpool number 10, written by Joe Kelly and art by Ed McGuinness.
It's the final issue in this current arc, and it's hilarious. It's so funny. Itsy Bitsy. They named the villain Itsy Bitsy. She's a combination of Spider-Man and Deadpool into one thing. She calls them Daddy. And it's... I have not seen a stronger commentary of homosexual relationships, and it is beautiful. Genuinely beautiful.
That's all you got to say?
Yeah, it's great. Pick it up. The book's hilarious. Right. I would say actually wait for the first volume, then try it out. I wouldn't tell you to get it. You would have a great time with it.
Yeah, I'm sure I'd have fun with it. Mm-hmm. Next up, Star Wars number 24, written by Jason Aaron and art by George Molina.
This is so good! Ah! Sorry.
I don't know what that was.
It's my mild freak because I love the Star Wars line. It's so good. And oh, the next issue is going to be amazing. It's the ending, like the reveal, like this is what's happened. You've been played the whole time kind of thing, which is so good. Oh, man, it's such a good story. Just the whole ending bit was just so perfect in every capacity. I'm like, oh, this is going to get great. Good. Pick it up. Star Wars is amazing. It's just wonderful. Oh, it's been so good so far. Everything they've been producing is in quality for me.
Next up, Star Wars Poe Dameron number 7, written by Charles Soule and art by Phil Noto.
From what I understand, this is a one-shot, story, and it was very good.
Really?
It was a very good story. Yeah, I liked it a lot. It was this kind of cool story about this investigative reporter and her experiences with the rebellion in Poe Dameron. It's good. I liked it. It's a lot of fun. It's really entertaining. It got me to giggle a little bit. Poe's an arrogant little turd, and I love him. I love Poe Dameron.
He was probably one of my favorite new characters from Force Awakens.
I really liked Finn personally. That well-meaning good guy.
Yeah,
he's
yeah.
so well-meaning, but he comes from a bunch of villains, and he's so well-meaning. All right.
I'd like to think I'm Poe in some capacity, but then I look in the mirror, I'm like, you're not Poe.
You're not slick enough. You're not Oscar Isaac levels of handsome.
You're not slick enough to be Poe.
Neither am I. But
next up, Suicide Squad number 5, written by Rob Williams and art by Jim Lee.
Robin Williams is on this?
You made that joke last episode and it wasn't funny. Or the week before.
I found it funny.
Yeah, it's getting better.
Yeah, I think so. I like this issue.
I was mistaken on it being part of the same arc. It's still continuing from it, but it's going by a different arc name now. I thought it was going to be like
I guess it's a new arc.
Yeah, but still continuing. I thought it was going to be like part 5, mm-hmm. but now it's part 1 of a new story.
I guess that makes sense. I'm
mixed on where this can go. This could either go really good or really bad.
This next arc is either Waller realizing that she cannot continue being as arrogant as she is, or it's going to go of, this is going to be an interesting one. Justice League versus Suicide Squad happens.
Yeah. I still don't care for Hack.
I like her. I like the ending bit. We got to hear some of her backstory. That was kind of cool.
Yeah. I just don't find her compelling.
I like the whole... it's hard. I don't want to spoil it. I like why she's a bad guy, because it's one of those you kind of did it to yourself. You kind of deserve being in prison right now.
Yeah.
Where everyone else is like, oh, you're crazy, or there's special circumstances where really you could be more suited to get more psychiatric help. And this one, I'm like, no, Hack totally deserves to be in prison.
There was... Oh, that's right. Okay, so I was thinking to myself after I read her little thing, her little backup story.
Mm-hmm.
She's pretty much a combination of Livewire and Cyborg.
Livewire, I can see. Cyborg, though?
Connected to the internet?
I guess. I can kind of give you that in a way. I don't know. I disagree with that a little bit.
I don't know.
Yeah, it's fine.
It's okay. I'll have to wait to see how well they develop her. I don't know why they.
I still like it. I mean, I think it's
yeah. She's not gratingly bad. She's just mm-hmm. I
She's a Harley Quinn fangirl.
Yeah.
And she gets caught out on it, too, which is pretty great.
Yeah.
By Harley Quinn, of all people. Sorry about that, guys.
Next up is Titans number 4, written by Dan Abnett and art by Brett Booth. This was the second book I read this week. I have to know what happens to Wally.
Yeah, it is pretty good. It's just, it's building and building and building and building, and I think this is the issue where I thought we were going to get all everything we wanted. Now it's building again, and the next issue is everything's going to come to fold. I'm like,
I need answers. This needs to be bi-weekly.
Yeah, this needs to be bi-weekly. This book needs to be bi-weekly. I love
this book so much.
If you need a change, just make Deathstroke monthly and make this bi-weekly. Like, come on,
this
man.
This is so good. Just I like it a lot.
Just do me that favor, guys. Come on, please.
I really like the relationships in this book.
I do, too.
It's a lot of nice character moments.
All right, guys. Well, I guess now time to get to our highlights.
No, we still got one more.
Really?
Yeah, because we screwed up the notes.
Oh, yeah. Wonder Woman number 9.
Yeah, Wonder Woman number 9, written by Greg Rucka and art by Liam Sharp. This is part of the Lies storyline that is going in tandem with the Truth.
Truth.
Or Year One or however, whatever.
No. It's year one. Lies and Year One.
Yeah. I like it
a lot. I do, too.
I don't know if you caught this, but there's a bit for the people who haven't read it yet or who have read it. The bit where Wonder Woman takes Barbara Ann Minerva to go get some clothes, and she steps out of the department store. A lot of the signs for the stores are named after people who have worked on Wonder Woman.
Mm-hmm. Really?
Yeah, there's one called Azzarello. There's one that's Perez.
That's so cute.
There's some other ones, but I was like, that's a nice little tribute.
That's pretty cool. It was a good book.
The art was fantastic.
Wonder Woman looks very warm. Things happened in it that I've been wanting to happen for years. Something sort of I feel fixed. I'm curious where the story's going to go. Real fast, getting off Wonder Woman, we actually forgot to include a book. Hellraiser came out this week.
Oh.
Yeah. There's a Johnny Cash reference in it.
That makes
sense. There's a Johnny Cash reference in Hellraiser. Hellblazer. I kind of want to watch Hellraiser now. Yeah, Hellblazer came out. It was good. Fine. I'm interested to see where the next issue goes. Its story is starting to get a little boring, not going to lie. But I want to see where the story goes. I'm actually kind of excited. There's a Johnny Cash reference, and you can't go wrong with Johnny Cash reference.
Now, one more thing before we get into the highlights. Liam Sharp draws Wonder Woman very reminiscent of Linda Carter, and I dig it a lot. And she has a lot of warmth to her face. Like, you can see the warmth in her eyes.
That is really nice.
She just looks so sweet.
I love Linda Carter's.
I want to give her a hug.
I like Linda Carter's response to the whole like controversy with
that, which is stupid.
It's like, it's silly. I'm like, yes, it is, Linda. Stupid. Yes, it is, Miss Carter.
For an ideology focused on not shaming women for how they dress and more on how they act and what they do, you're sure doing a lot of the judging right there.
Yeah. It's back just a little bit.
Oh, yeah. So next up, we're going to the highlights. First off, we got Action Comics number 966, written by Dan Jurgens and art by Steven Segovia. I actually went and tagged Dan Jurgens in a post because I'm friends with him on Facebook. And I told
Good for you, princess.
I told him... Dan Jurgens, every issue, you keep knocking it out of the park. Thank you for making Superman comics fun again. And that's what this comic is. It's a lot of fun. It's a lot of heartfelt stuff. The ending,
whole ending sequence between Clark and Lois talking it out and like talking through a genuine, I feel, couples problem after having a kid, like something a couple's talk about after having a kid. You know, one of them having to be out of work versus them having to be out of work for so long or whatever. Genuinely good, interesting conversation to where I feel if you're an adult reading this, you can kind of relate to it. I feel if you're a kid, you can see it through John's point of view.
Yeah.
And you relate to it. And it's really heartwarming to see how everything was handled. In a lot of ways, when the family's together, it reads like a family book, like a book about
people criticize it for that. And I'm like,
but I think that makes it really
that's
good.
That's what makes it strong, because Clark is a family man at heart.
Mm-hmm. I think it makes it relatable, too, to be perfectly honest with you. I think this makes why it's so good.
Totally.
This book is fantastic and honestly amazing.
I love the moments where...
If you can look me in the eyes and tell me that Superman is not just entirely great character, you have not picked up these series.
He's a total dad.
Yeah, he's a total dad. And he makes a great dad. This is a great book. Clark does a great job. I'm like, okay, yeah, it's weird how... The story of this Clark Kent and what happened and whatnot, but who cares? Just pick up the books and read them.
That's
fun.
Part of the intrigue, the mystery. It's about the people more than the questions. That, and I found out that Clark apparently makes some pretty killer meatballs. He says it's better than Arthur, or sure. Better than...
I'm sure Batman knows that.
He says it's better than... Oliver's chili.
Completely ignoring me.
Oh, yeah, Oliver's...
yeah, he's like, it's better than always chili.
And then John's just like, ooh, I need...
Next up is Detective Comics number 963, written by James Tynion IV and art by Alvaro Martinez.
The main story that this is going on itself, because it's the first issue of a new arc, isn't why I wanted to highlight this. I wanted to highlight this because this is the book that finally takes the time to actually discuss the effects of Tim's death on the entire team. And it's finally... It gives you what you want. You get to see how everyone's handling it, and you get a little bit of everything. Clayface seems to be kind of not really understanding because he wants to feel bad, but he doesn't really know how because he isn't related to this person.
Yes.
Orphan seems to be gravitating more toward Clayface, kind of ignoring it in a way, trying not to think about it the best she can. Also trying to keep the team together.
Yeah.
Like trying to keep them talking, get them to do events together. Like she makes Bluebird promise her to go to this like function thing, and ultimately making Spoiler go to it as well, because Spoiler has been isolating herself because her and Tim were in a relationship, and it was really cute and sweet. It was honestly very beautiful. Tim opened up to her a lot, told her a lot of his like feelings, revealed to her that he didn't want to be Robin anymore. He wanted to get his degree to do some real good in the world by contributing to it, which I feel is awesome. I think that's a great thing. So it was cool to see her response to it. And you got Batman, of course, who's isolating himself like he did during after Jason's death. He's isolating himself. He's separating himself. He's afraid to be near the team because now all the team reminds him is him. We have this really great moment where you can see he's not trying not to cry, but he's sitting there, his hands in his head, his hand in his lap, with this like really like just not even scowl, but this genuinely destroyed face. I see him inside the base, a monument to Tim, just like he had for Jason. With it standing in his like famous pose, like, you know, arms out like this, the staff out. It was really cool, and it was heartbreaking. Honestly, it was really really touching, and I really appreciated it a lot. And then there's Batwoman, who's just trying to keep everyone together, who's trying to keep everyone working together, but she can't. Like, you can see how hard it is for her to do this, to try to be the backbone when she wants to break down. It's really cool to see how rough it is on everybody, and not because I like seeing the pain. I like. Those are parts of Batman I like, are the emotional moments. Most of
the human element.
The human element of Batman is just fascinating because it's really interesting to try to, A, see him argue about why he can do what he do and still call himself a good person. Because in a lot of ways, he's not necessarily the great of a person. Him constantly battling the human side of him while trying to keep the emotionless detective side. And then him working with other people and his connections. The Bat family, you've even said, the Bat family... as a conglomerate, is the most interesting comic book family ever. It's just they're constantly interacting with each other, constantly growing together, constantly building together, and it's beautiful. It's really, really cool, and it's always so nice. It's why I love Detective Comics, because the Bat family really, it's a Bat family book. They're all people come in and out.
Totally.
Everyone's getting involved. You got Bluebird in this one. She's a newer addition to the Bat family, but it's really cool to see her. I don't think Alfred was in this issue, but it was just
he drove the cab.
You're right.
He made a joke. I forgot what it was. But he was being a smart aleck.
No, it was Batwoman was tearing into Batman about how he's been reacting to Tim's death and not appreciating the gravity of everybody else, not taking consideration how everyone else feels. And then Bruce looks at Alfred. Do you have anything else to add? Oh no, sir, I think she's handling this quite well, thank you. And I'm like, you cheeky little turd, I love you. If you were anybody else's butler, you'd be fired.
I liked it a lot.
So did I.
It was one of the first three books that I read this week. Next up is Flash number 9, written by Joshua Williamson and art by Neil Gouge. Not
the Gouge.
Not the Gian Domenico. Oh. I said it. Ah. He's taking a break?
Really? Interesting.
He's coming back. He or she.
I think this book looked great. It's a one-shot story about the two Wallys. The two Wallys. Thank you. I was thinking West. What's their first name again? The two Wallys meeting, and I thought it was really cool.
So the other reason that I really want to highlight this, aside from the stuff that potentially leads to bigger DC universe goings on, this tribute cover to Flash number 123.
Yeah.
I love those of
you who are listening to the podcast and aren't watching the video, which I promise this time it will be up. The issue has, if you've ever seen Flash 123, it's Flash and what was it
Jay Garrick's
Earth 2 Flash. It was them running to save Iris, was it?
No, it's just a person that was.
Oh, was it just a person that was Iris?
And they said, "Hey, Flash, save me!" And they're both racing along this wall, and they're like, "I'm coming!" Mm-hmm. At the same time.
And it's the same. It's the tribute, but it's the two Wallys trying to save Barry.
But there's this neat little bit on here, and usually whenever they do a reference to a previous comic cover, they'll do after so and so. Now the person that drew this, Carmine D. Giandomenico. Wrote from Carmine to Carmine because Carmine Infantino drew the original, and I'm like, oh, I dig that so much.
It's right here in this corner, right?
Yeah, that's I dig cute. That a lot.
That's pretty cute.
I love the Silver Age a lot.
So do I. Silver Age is fun, man.
It's really good. There's a lot of really nice character moments in this.
Good
book.
Is one thing, fun is another. I'll give you fun, but I'll argue with the good aspect a little bit.
Good in that it gives me a lot of character moments that I like.
It's good for Superman.
For Superman.
Silver Age.
No, I was talking about this issue.
Oh, I'm talking about Silver Age.
Oh, wow. Talk about disconnect on the conversation. No, for this book, I was talking about the character moments. There's a lot of great character moments in this book.
All right. Next up.
Hal Jordan and the Green Lantern Corps number 7, written by Robert Venditti and art by Rafael Sandoval.
Sorry. It's the last issue of this arc, and let's just say that went places.
Things happened.
And we wanted to highlight it, one, because I thought the art was awesome.
It was really
I thought
good.
It was beautiful.
For half a second, I thought that, because there's a bit where Hal and Sinestro are fighting each other,
mm-hmm.
and Sinestro is going on about, oh, we used to be buddies when you first joined the Corps, and mm-hmm. I was teaching you how to be a Lantern.
Uh-huh.
And they have little flashback things inside of the panels, and I'm like, wait a minute, is that Kenneth Rockefeller? And I had to go back. I'm like, no, that's the same artist. That's Rafael Sandoval doing that. Huh, that's new. Different inker doing mm-hmm. that. And it looked really good.
It did look really good.
Something happened with our covers, though. For the shipment that came to Docking Bay, the covers are slightly blurry. There's a little bit of displacement.
Yeah, you can really see it in the barcode. It's like the barcode's really where you notice it.
There's a little bit of displacement on the printing.
Maybe that'll make it unique and rare. Maybe that'll be put my kids through college.
It's...
This really book is fat as amazing. This is a great ending to this arc, which leads a huge, like, oh my god, what happens in the next issue? Because some people may be dead. Some people may not be dead. Things have been blown open that I haven't been blown open in a long time, like my hype for Green Lantern, which hasn't existed since classic Justice League television show when I was a kid that was animated. And that was only because Jon Stewart's awesome. And I'm going to continue doing this voice because I like this voice.
I don't know how you keep doing that.
I don't either.
There's not really much we can say without spoiling it.
We just wanted to talk about it because it was really cool. We tried to pick this up. If you like Green Lantern, pick this up. If you don't like Green Lantern, this is definitely
great battle.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Everything about the Lantern Corps is great.
Next up is Renato Jones, the 1%, number 5, written and drawn by Kyle Andrews.
I love this book because it. Okay, this is a book made by Image. You haven't read it. I've been trying to convince you for a while to read it.
You have?
Yes, I have. Every time I get it, I'm like, hey, you should check this book out. And you're like, oh, maybe one day.
That's my answer for everything.
Yeah, I know. There's so many, like, not DC things, but not Marvel things I want to get you into, and this is one of them. Basically, the premise of this series is that this guy who was rich, was then poor. Weird story beginning, but basically this poor orphaned kid took it in by this rich family. Whole thing where he was maybe one day rich, but turns out he wasn't. It's a really weird beginning. Decides that he's going to start killing rich people who have been draining the world, like who drains the economy, who ruin poor people that are just terrible human beings. And they're all genuinely terrible human beings he's killing. And it's just about his story. The art is weird. Like this, Andrew's art is weird. His writing is weird. It's a weird, weird book. It's strange, doesn't make much sense, but man, is it cool. Oh my god, it's intense, it's interesting. It's the most different book I've read in a long time. It's got this really cool way it does its art to where it'll just suddenly change on a dime. It'll be in color, then black and white. Color again. One color. Black and red.
Huh.
And it's very artistic. It's very... It's surreal. It's a very surrealist comic. If I had to say this is an example of like surrealism in comics, this is it. The story's very surreal. The art's very surreal. How the story and the art play together is very surreal. They'll use a text box to they'll use text box coloring to deliver twists, which is pretty cool. It's fascinating. I'm not telling people to pick up the single issues. This is the ending of season one, which was the bomb, beginning to end, awesome. It's very mature. It's got nudity, language. He's literally the main character's catchphrase is "choke on this."
Reading them devil books.
Yeah, I was flipping through it, and there's like one picture of a girl like completely naked, just like laying down with sushi on her. And Mario's just like,
"What?
Why are you reading those devil books?" No. It was a bunch of robots, which they're going to. The next thing they're going to attack the main character, and it pops out or dildos, and they're apparently going to use them to kill the main character. And Mario just comes in, looks at it, and it's just like, "What are you reading?"
Yeah.
And the look on his face is sheer confusion. It was the best.
Next up is Teen Titans number 1, written by Ben Percy and art by John Boy Myers. There's not a lot I can really say about this other than pick it up.
Yeah, great book.
It's really good. I like the art a lot. It's very reminiscent of the original Teen Titans animated show.
Yeah, we wanted to bring it up because it is the first issue, and we wanted to discuss it real fast, that it's really good, it's really fascinating, it's very reminiscent to the Teen Titans show.
It feels like it a lot.
It's just really great moments. It's really cool to see this team form together. It's really cool because you think Robin's going to be a jerk to them. It turns out it's really sweet.
He just wants friends.
He literally, this book is Damian admitting that all he wants is friends. And I cannot help but feel emotional about this.
The moments between him and Alfred.
Oh, yeah. The moments between him and the rest of the team, man.
Oh, totally.
Oh, it's so great. It's so great. This is the first story is about Robin. It's Robin's family. And guess who's going to be the first villain? Ra's al Ghul. Oh, I'm pumped. Oh, I'm so pumped.
It's not spoilers because it's on the cover.
Yeah, it's like literally right there. And like they've been teasing it for the longest time that he's going to be the first villain. It's really amazing.
And it makes sense. Grandfather's got to come a-collecting.
Yeah. Great book. First issue, so we're going to highlight it real fast. Let you know you should pick this up. It was very fun. If you like the Teen Titans show, if you like Teen Titans like the group, this is great. This is better than Teen Titans New 52 runs.
Totally.
Garbage.
Absolutely. Next up is a book that was kind of short ordered at Docking Bay.
I thought I ordered it for myself, but apparently I didn't.
I was fortunate enough to have added it. It's the Wonder Woman 75th Anniversary one-shot.
And it's, take it over.
It's just got a bunch of various artists and writers. It's a celebratory issue that just encapsulates everything that is Wonder Woman. And aside from one or two minor quibbles that I had with the issue, everything in this was awesome. They had a section dedicated to the covers of Brian Boland, who did some stuff for the 90s Wonder Woman stuff. Mm-hmm. They had some unused sketch covers that he had done for the original series or something like that. They had a mock interview between Lois Lane and Wonder Woman that kind of ties into the stuff going on now.
I'm going to have John order me. John, if you're watching the show like right now, like right when we're recording, like right this second, can you order it for me, please?
Thanks, buddy. It's really good.
Thanks, buddy. You're the best. You know that, right? You know I love you guys.
There are little, I guess, advertisements or like trailers for The Legend of Wonder Woman, which is like a miniseries that's coming out pretty soon, which is pretty cool. It's set in 1940s.
Well, I'm definitely going to pick it up.
It's set in the 1940s. She's fighting Nazis and stuff. And then there's the one for that book that's in all of the DC books, the Legend of Wonder Woman. I had a minor quibble with that just because of one line of dialogue that I don't think Diana would ever say.
Oh, yeah.
And I showed it to you.
Yeah.
And if you read it, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about.
This book is more of a 75th anniversary book, just kind of memorializing Wonder Woman, saying, "Hey, she's a great character," and it's cool.
I have two things. One, I wish that, and I know it's kind of weird to want less for an anniversary thing, but I wish that DC would have done something like this for Superman's 75th and Batman's 75th instead of giving us 9 issues of mediocre.
They really whatever didn't do anything. They tried to claim Batman Eternal was their thing, but it totally wasn't because Batman Eternal had to be postponed. So they just kind of made an excuse like, "Oh, we're postponing it because of this." Like, no, you postponed it because it wasn't done yet. I don't blame you because it's a lot of work.
But for Superman Unchained, it barely captured the essence of the character. Mm-hmm. This captures the essence of the character. The last story in this made me tear up. Mm-hmm. And it is awesome. The only other thing that I had a problem with is that I wish that they would have pushed this a little bit more.
Same. I do too. Well, everybody, that's been our collection discussion. Well, not collection discussion, comics discussion. So just so you know, I wanted to just bring up again, we occasionally forget because we're bad about it. We get a lot of comments for Docking Bay 94. You see it every time you turn on the show. You see it's right in between the two of us. Just wanted to mention, you know, they're great. They're awesome. They help promote our show. They watch it. They give us opinions. They laugh at us for the movies we go see and subject ourselves to.
Oh, yeah, they do that a lot.
Yeah, they do. John tears. Just great makes, people. Makes fun of me every time. He's just like, really? Really? You're all going to do it? I'm like, yeah. Yeah, we are.
They're good people.
Tell him we get to Garbage Day. It's American Pastoral. But I told him we were saying that. He's like, what? Like, he didn't, like, I've never heard of that. I'm like, yeah, I wish I didn't either. But guys, like always, promote, you know, help with your little comic book store. You know, be there for them whenever you can. Let's move on. You gonna do your collection thing? You gonna discuss the collection? Go ahead. Okay. What do you got first? Because you're the only one with things this week. I don't have anything.
Oh, God. Okay. So that's good because I have a lot of stuff. Let me just move some stuff on the table.
Don't move my Dementor.
Well, in the mail, I happen to have gotten a Superman figure from 1996. This is put out by Kenner, and it's the Kmart exclusive one. It's pretty much the same one you get in the History of Superman 3-pack.
This is Superman just after death, isn't it?
Yep.
Because it's longer hair. Uh-huh. It looks like it got a mullet. Superman's got a mullet. And the lifeless eyes terrify me.
It's not bad. The only real problem I have, because it's got like the cloth cape and the cloth suit and stuff, and it looks really nice. My big problem is that they reused the same body from the G.I. Joe figures and the Star Wars figures. Mm-hmm. And the problems that they had with that is that there's very, very limited articulation on that. And so when you put him on the stand, he leans at this weird angle. So you have to really adjust his
Mario's trying to keep his steady because I'm messing with Superman's crotch, and he just can't. He's trying so hard, but he's like stuttering and he's trying not to laugh. Okay, I'll stop now, buddy.
You have to mess with like the hip joints, and you have to mess with like the swivel rotation on his torso to make him look like he's standing like an actual person.
Can I raise his arms up at all? No, not doing that. Yeah. Woo, almost broke his suit.
Yeah, it very...
Let's not do that again.
Yeah, it's not bad. I like it. It looks nice. I have it over by my TV when I have it displayed.
It's pretty cool. I like it.
I got it in an auction. I was the only bidder.
He bought a Barbie. Mario bought a Barbie. A Superman Barbie, that's basically
I actually
it is.
Do have a Superman Barbie. Next up,
I was just kidding,
had gone to Barnes & Noble, and I finally picked up a Rick and Morty Pop.
Oh, yeah, the Morty Pop where he puts the seeds up his butt.
Yeah.
It's the one where, if you've seen the first episode, he's holding the seeds, one on each hand.
They increase knowledge when they're anally inserted.
Yeah. But they calls you to, like, spaz out or something for a couple
Rick and Morty 100 years forever, rickandmorty.com. So I finally picked
him up. Hashtag Rick and Morty.
I finally picked him up, and I'm really happy. I just need to find Rick, and I'm sure I can get one.
Oh, yeah.
At Docking Bay.
You can't have one of mine.
I also happened to pick up a couple of CDs. The first one I picked up is the Killers album Hot Fuss.
Oh, no, wait. Let me check it out. Cool. This is a good album.
Yeah.
What's got on here? What songs we got on here? Oh, we got a... Jenny Was a Friend of Mine. I like that song. Mr. Brightside's awesome.
It is.
Oh, such a good album. The cover's really cool. It's really simplistic with like the tops of the buildings, the little Chinese symbols on it. I like it. Go ahead. Continue with your second album.
And then the next album, they finally had a... Because usually when they have albums at Best Buy, they finally... Or
cheap
they usually
thrillers. Big Brother and the Holding Company.
Yeah, Janis Joplin.
Because
usually for awesome. Janis Joplin, they either have Best Of albums or live in concert stuff. And so it's very hard to find some stuff that is like actual studio albums, and this is like their big album that had like all the big hits on there, like their cover of Summertime, and then it had
she's so pretty,
I love her
Janis
a lot.
Janis Joplin, such a
and
beautiful
then
individual.
Piece of My Heart,
uh-huh.
Classic. It's got the classic cover drawn by cartoonist Robert Crumb,
who's it's really
fantastic.
Cool.
He had done the Fritz the Cat stuff.
Uh-huh. I like it a lot. It's really cool.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I like this. Sorry, I'm just kidding. I love Janis Joplin. She's just awesome.
And because I like buying books, I got
God.
I got the second volume in the Superman Silver Age dailies. This is everything from 1961 to 1963. Everything in there is done by Wayne Boring. And I'm
so
excited.
I'm just flipping through this. Is it Superman in a security guard outfit? What's
yes, it is.
Here?
Yes, it is.
This is really cool.
I'm trying to collect the rest of the Superman dailies and the Sunday classics, and they're relatively expensive, like $30 and up, and that it's going to be a gradual thing.
But man, that is cool.
This is stuff that, I mean, the series was in production from 1939 to 1966, continuously. That's impressive.
Oh, wow, you're only missing one more, aren't you?
For the Silver Age, yeah, and then I have to get the last of the Golden Age and then the Atomic Age.
Huh, this is really cool, man.
I like those a lot.
I might actually steal one of these from you. I just sold it at a time and start reading them. I just want to read them. Let's start getting some of this stuff off the table because now it's starting to pile up.
Yeah.
Let's take that. Careful with your albums. Do not break them. Janis Joplin album, please. Do not break the Janis Joplin album. I'd be very upset with you. Break the Janis Joplin album. You can break the Superman toy, though. It looks a little weird. The Superman Barbie.
A little weird.
Yeah. The face, dude. The face creeps me out.
The face is a little bit weird. But the main reason that I went to Barnes & Noble it was on the day that they had done the United Nations honorary ambassador thing for Wonder Woman. They did the live stream of that. And I'm like, you know what? This also happened to have been the day that the first...
Coincidentally.
Coincidentally, it was also the day that the first Wonder Woman comic was put out. Which, if I'm not mistaken, that's Sensation Comics number 8. No. No.
Wait, let's go to the beginning of this book, and it won't tell us. Thank you very much, book. I appreciate the help.
No, because I think she was in an issue with the Justice Society.
I don't know.
Or something to that effect. I'm not really up on my Wonder Woman knowledge. I just know that I really adore the character.
Continue.
But I wanted to go and get something to commemorate this big day. And so I went and I got the... Oh, All-Star Comics number 8. That's
there
right.
You go.
Yeah, because Sensation Comics was her title, I think. Or she was in that, and then she eventually got her own title.
Mm-hmm.
But I wanted to get something to commemorate today, so I got the Essential Wonder Woman Encyclopedia. And it's pretty cool.
God, some of this old Wonder Woman art is freaking beautiful. Some of it's just gorgeous looking.
Now, I was a little bit confused, because I was like, all right, well, let's look up some certain entries. Let's look up Superwoman, which is the Earth 3 version of Wonder Woman.
Mm-hmm.
Couldn't find her under Superwoman. All right, well, let's look up Earth 3. Not in there. I'm like, huh, that's weird.
That's a
pretty big oversight. And I'm like, all right, well, let's look at Wonder Woman's entry.
And then we got Superwoman's in there.
Wonder Woman of Earth 3. Wonder Woman of Earth 2.
I guess that makes sense because they're all technically different versions of Wonder Woman. So
yeah,
Wonder
it was just weird because I don't even think the Superman encyclopedia does it that way.
No, Batman's encyclopedia had at least a short bit for every individual Batman, and it was Earth this, Earth that, this Batman, that Batman. I think like only a couple words in the Batman main one. That was because it why bother?
Yeah.
I don't actually own it because it wasn't very good.
Oh, that's the next one that I want to get.
It's not very good.
It's not very good?
It's not very good. There's so many things missing in it. There's so many things that are wrong in it, too, that are just like, oh, it's DC just trying to rewrite some things. Like, oh, this never happened. Rewrite. I'm like, yeah, it totally did, dude. Calm down.
Oh. Okay, well...
It's a little frustrating, but there are also some cool things in there. I like the Villains Encyclopedia, because that puts all the weirdness. Basically, the problem with the Batman Encyclopedia was that it didn't accept any of the weirdness of the Silver Age Batman. Only some of it, like Kite Man. But only the safe things they could accept. Like, they barely talk about Batman wearing a rainbow suit, which is awesome. It's so classic. It, like, kind of talked about the giant penny. It's frustrating. But this book looks awesome. This Wonder Woman book, encyclopedia book.
I mean, I'll probably end up picking up the Batman one because I already got the Superman and the Wonder Woman, so I might as well just complete the Trinity.
Some beautiful, beautiful art pages in here.
It's hardcover. It was only like $14.95 at Barnes & Noble.
Okay, I'm going to give this back to you.
Yeah. So, that was pretty rad.
It's heavy, though.
That was pretty rad.
Is that all?
Yeah, that's all I've got.
Well, guys, that was our collection.
I got one more thing in the mail. It was supposed to come today, and I was going to wear it, but...
Well, what was it?
It was a Superman cape.
Oh, so you're not wearing isn't
no,
that?
No, this one is part of my shirt. It's like a Velcro detachable one, but this one was like one that you actually wear for like the costumes and stuff. It was like one of the ones for like the $40 Halloween costumes. But it's like, you know what? It'd still be nice to have one that actually, you know, I can wear.
All right, guys. Well, this week we decided to do something a little different for our topics. Considering it's Halloween and we want to do some Halloween stuff, we're going to have three different things we're going to discuss, all involving Halloween. First up is kind of an obvious one, since it's still our first Halloween together, is why do we love Halloween? Because I love Halloween. You love Halloween. I think I like Halloween a little bit more. Halloween's my favorite holiday. It's like my personal all-time favorite holiday. I love it. I think it's the best thing. I just have so much fun. I love the ability to just be whoever you want. Because when growing up, me as a kid, I was a weird kid. It's because I
was.
Thanks. Thanks.
Those who live in glass houses should not cast stones.
Yes. So growing up, I was kind of that weird kid that no one really liked to talk to. I really had a lot of trouble making friends, and I had a lot of trouble, like, I swear to God, Mario, things haven't changed much.
I was still laughing at the stones.
But my willingness to punch you has gotten more severe right now. So Halloween was always kind of like that one holiday that I was able to be how weird and out there as I wanted to be, watch whatever I wanted to watch, and no one ever judged me for it, because, oh, it's Halloween, it's weird because it's Halloween, and like, that's was always cool. I always appreciated the holiday because it's one holiday that I would feel there's no expected commitment from you. You can do what you want. When I was a kid, I went trick-or-treating. When I'm back at home for Halloween, I go trick-or-treating with my little brother, where I saw hand out candy with my mom and my grandma, which is always a good time, because I always like seeing the kids' costumes, because they're so cool, man. Some kids are so creative.
Oh, yeah. Especially when they make their own.
Mm-hmm.
I was one of the kids that made their own costumes.
Yeah, I was. My mom is a vet, so she was able to get that kind of, like, the wrapping. You put mummies, like, kind of gauze that look like mummy wrapping. We colored it a bit. And I was
that's
really
cool.
Cool mummy one year.
Do you guys use, like, tea bags and stuff, or, like, tea to kind of stain it?
We use coffee.
Okay, even better.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
it was awesome, man.
And you smell like Java.
Mm-hmm. I did Dracula one. I've done Dracula. I did Frankenstein. I've done a bit of everything. I did the pirate for a couple of years. I did this really cool pirate outfit, and then I tore it up and like destroyed it. And then the next year, did this really dirty pirate outfit. It looked awesome.
Oh, you could have done a zombie pirate.
This year, like I said, I'm gonna we're having a Halloween party the 29th, so I'm going for the Halloween party. Me and my girlfriend are dressing up as circus ringleaders, which I'm really excited for. I think it's gonna have a lot of fun with. I haven't done that before. Yeah, I'm gonna do makeup. Well, I'm gonna do makeup on me, which is gonna be a lot of fun. I'm really excited.
Should you do your makeup like Alice Cooper?
I have been trying to think of things I want to do. Alice Cooper might be it. I don't know. I actually went to did a Halloween, like, I what was it? There's this Haunted Woods thing back in Tampa. People my dad were with, they do for money, for charity, it's a long story, but they, for a couple of years, I was out there helping out with the haunted houses, and I can tell you right now that if I ever become rich, I'm going to make my own haunted house, because that's life goals right there. But Halloween's always been a way for, it's the one holiday that I don't just like, I relate to, and I can be, I feel like I can be myself on. I'm not afraid to be me on Halloween, which, though I'm growing up, I was afraid to be myself, and I had a lot of problems, because I was picked on a lot as a kid, and people didn't really understand me, but Halloween was that one time a year I could do whatever I wanted, and no one really cared, because they're like, oh, it's Halloween, who cares? So it allowed me to really, like, I feel the most comfortable on that day. It's my, I say, I take off work. I do stuff all day. I'll go out. If there's something going on in the mall, this year, they're doing like a whole trick or treating thing in the mall. I'm going over there. Yeah, I know, right? It's so cool. I'm not doing that.
This is Boca. Do they give out full size Snickers?
I don't know.
They can afford it.
I'm gonna find out what's going on in the area for Halloween. Just to see people's costumes. That's a lot of fun. If I can get it off, I'm going to spend, like, most of the morning and afternoon, I'm going to read, I'm going to watch movies. Just going to watch movies all day. You think your mom's coming down for, no, she's going to be gone by that point, won't it? Because that's a Monday.
Yeah.
You're always allowed to come over and watch movies with me.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I kind of want to go and do an open mic thing in my David Bowie outfit.
Collectors Coalition, the show where we make plans on air. So, Halloween was super important for me, and it always has been. My mom and my dad, bless their souls, have always been super supportive. It's one of my mom's favorite holidays, too. And my dad, he's not a big holidays kind of guy. He doesn't like Halloween because his birthday is like literally three or four days before. So he's had a birthday / Halloween party for him as a kid. So it's kind of bitter distaste. But he and my mom both were very understanding. And I guess kind of understood why I liked it so much. And always saw how much of a difference it made in me. And how much better I felt during that day. Like, I felt better. I felt comfortable. I felt like I was comfortable in my own skin. I felt like it was a day that I feel like I belonged in a way. So they were all both so supportive of me on that day. And I always appreciate how supportive they were. It's like there's one day a year they're super supportive. It's that one day a year. And it's a big deal for me. I love everything about it. I love the costumes. I love the movies. I love the candy. Hey guys, sorry about that. My computer ran out of power. I had to plug it in real fast. We had to start the show kind of on a dime, which is probably a good thing because I was rambling on a bit. But so yeah, Halloween's just super important to me, you know? It's just the one holiday that I love. I have a great time, and I'm usually really happy during it. But you, what do you like Halloween for?
Well, I like the costumes.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of weird for me because I had to go between parents' houses for Halloween. So yeah. One year I would be with my mom, 1 year I would be with my dad. And my dad did the Halloween thing. We would go trick-or-treating, and we would actually get, like, store-bought costumes, which is kind of rad. My mom, on the other hand, is Baptist. She doesn't really do the whole Halloween thing. She's not really down with it. She doesn't mind it. She just, as a kid, she didn't really want me doing it.
Okay.
But we would go and do, like, fall festivals at the church. Back when,
those are always fun.
Yeah, they're fun. I mean, you can still have fun. And
you can have fun with Jesus.
But growing up, I was not technically an only child.
Mm-hmm.
Like, biologically, I am an only child. Also, this rabbit needs to calm down.
Be nice to my croissant.
Croissant? Want a bite of my croissant?
Hey.
But technically, I am an only child, but my mom got remarried, and so I got some stepkids, or stepkids.
You got stepkids?
I got stepkids.
Oh, God, Mario!
Yeah.
Jesus!
This is why I'm broke. I'm also paying child support. No, I got step-siblings.
This show got dark all of a sudden.
You know what? You try running 17 hours on 3 hours of sleep.
Continue. Calm down.
And so we wouldn't really get to do, like, the store-bought costumes. We would actually have to make our own costumes using stuff lying around the house. And so 1 year, me and my siblings all did characters from Star Wars. And it was so cool. I think I was Anakin. My stepbrother was Luke. My younger stepsister was Leia. I don't even think my older stepsister did anything for that. I think she did her own thing. But we would make our own costumes. And so I've kind of carried on that tradition. So starting in my senior year of high school, I dropped $300 to make a Superman costume. $300.
That seems expensive.
It was expensive. Last year, my costume was just face paint and some black clothing. I went as King Diamond. He's a metal singer. This year, I'm going as David Bowie, and I've dropped at least $50 on this costume.
It's going to look pretty great. I had creative say, a little creative pull in this, and I was pretty proud.
I bought $30 boots. This better be
See,
awesome.
That's what I told you, man. You shouldn't have gone for the $3. I get what you're trying to do, but man, the boots, you'll wear them one time.
You don't know that. They actually look pretty rocking.
Mario, with your whole self-image thing, you are not going to walk around in women's boots. I know you too well.
You don't know me.
That's Mario's answer for, yeah, you're probably right.
Well, either way, they look really cool, and if not, we can use them as props or a costume wardrobe
for
films.
We can figure something else out with them, yeah. Well, guys.
Also candy.
There's a little tradition with me on Halloween, and like I think I mentioned it before during my whole spiel about why Halloween's the greatest Halloween holiday ever. I have this whole thing with tradition of where I love to watch horror movies on Halloween. I just pick a bunch of random movies I want to watch. It's a big day for me to watch some new things, try new things. Sometimes I'll have a friend of mine come over and I'll watch what they love, their favorite horror movies. Since I just love horror movies in general, I just love the genre as a whole. It all depends on who I'm with. Sometimes if it's you, I'll pick something that neither one of us has seen, and then I'll put some of what you like because I'll just watch whatever. The only movie I require to watch every Halloween. Only movie I require to watch every Halloween, same with every Christmas, is that I require to watch them before Christmas. every year. My favorite movie. I require it every year on Halloween and Christmas and Thanksgiving. Never before Christmas. It's required.
Okay.
So, I thought it'd be good. This is a good time to discuss because me and Mario love horror films.
Yeah.
Wow. I thought it'd get a bigger reaction from you than that.
Hey, if Gene Wilder got away with it and Willy Wonka, I can get away with it here. There's a moment where he's like, yeah. The really high pitch, yeah.
Just staring at you. Like, this is the weirdest time for that reference.
I make really obscure references. You should know
this
by now.
It's not obscure. It's poorly timed. So we love horror films. And I think this is a good time to kind of talk about what about the horror genre really connects with us. You know, I went first last time. Why don't you go ahead first this time?
I think I really like horror films because sometimes you need to embrace the fact that you can be scared. That yeah. It's okay to be scared. This is a genre that takes that and runs with it.
Mm-hmm.
I can go in one direction where it's like straight up crazy. Like you're not going to sleep for days. Or it can go in a direction where it's like, yeah, this is kind of stupid, but hey, we're having fun with it. Like
it's sort of that the difference between kind of like the horror, the saw slash stick, which is like slapstick mixed with a slasher, such as like what's it
Evil
called?
Dead?
Evil Dead 2. Evil Dead 2 is kind of like very funny, but like it's meant to be funny, but horror, it's a horror film that's kind of entertaining. But then the exact opposite, you got things like Babadook, The Shining, a bunch of other great horror films.
Krampus
isn't really scary because Krampus is more that comedy horror. There's the line, there's ones that are like genuinely terrifying, and then you have ones that are actually a lot of fun because horror is very unique genre. It doesn't have to be just scary, it could be really uncomfortable or really unnerving.
I like it because it communicates the message that it's okay to be scared every now and then, and sometimes people just need a good scare. It's fun. It's fun to be scared.
It's the reason why there's always be a market for horror movies. There's always be a market for people who want to be scared. It's just a natural thing that humans like to. Humans don't like to feel, but since we don't have the problem to where every day we're having to fear for our lives, like in the wild, I think that a part of our animal instinct has that kind of wanting to have it now because it's almost underused in a way. Excuse me. I feel it's very animalistic. Like, we want to be scared in a way.
We need to be.
Yeah, we need to be scared. We enjoy it.
It's a human thing. Mm-hmm. It's also part of a thing that I know that Nostalgia Critic touched on, but sometimes it's okay to let that kind of seep into kids' stuff, too. Like, let them be scared.
Yeah, just let it. Let them
learn to deal with that emotion.
I think Coraline does it the best, honestly. That ending whole sequence of her and like the spider thing was terrifying.
My little
brother was freaked out by it. This was actually really scary, but that's why he liked it, because he felt that, and it was very safe. It was a safe fear. I love horror. Horror is one of my top three favorite film genres, with Western and sci-fi. Those are my three favorites, and horror holds a special place in my heart because of its ability to do anything. It's sort of like sci-fi for me. You can do anything in a horror movie. As long as it's creepy or unnerving, you're fine. Like, as long as it has that kind of dark fear element in there. There's something scary has to have fear in it. It has to have the essence of what that kind of fear feeling. Like, Evil Dead 2 is a horror movie that you're not afraid of. It's very entertaining, but still a horror. It's got monsters. It's got this like very dark, horror-esque element to it. It's hard to describe it other than horror element to it. It's got an element of horror behind it. Not scary, but horror. And I always appreciate that. I just said horror, not horror. Horror. That's better. And I love the genre because its ability to go anywhere. There's so... You have... The range of horror films is insane. You've got Alien, which is a horror, quiet, slow horror film in space with spaceships and stuff. That's awesome. And alien planets. It's amazing. And then you've got super, super grounded horror films like, I'm trying to think of a good example. Trying to think of one that's very grounded. I guess Friday the 13th has Halloween.
Yeah. The first one, before he starts to become...
Texas Chainsaw Massacre. A very grounded, It's not necessarily by the book, but it's based on a real story that happened to real people. Now, of course, it's heavily changed for the movie to be darker and much more insane, but it's grounded. It's based in it's people, real people the story's about, and it's horrifying because of that. It's got this one, and both are like exact opposites to where Alien uses lighting and sound. You got Texas Chainsaw Massacre, which uses color. Mm-hmm. It's used a color, and I would say sound, because sound is completely, it's god tier. It's amazing. But that's what's cool about the horror genre, is it has that gap. And then you have things, like Krampus and Evil Dead 2, which are hilarious. Krampus is a great time.
It is. I enjoy it.
There are parts of Krampus where I'm actually pretty freaked out, but you're enjoying it. It's so much fun. That it's sane when people try to say, oh, Krampus isn't real horror. No, Krampus understands horror to its T. It understands exactly what horror is, and that's what makes it so entertaining.
It's a love letter to everything 80s horror.
And you get things like what we're going to discuss today, like Cabin in the Woods, which we'll discuss later. We're discussing in a rerun today, which is not really scary, but that movie is the quintessential. Everything you love about horror is in that movie. It's just a love letter to the horror genre, and it's just such a commentary on the horror genre. It's amazing. We'll discuss it later, because we're doing the rewind. It's a perfect movie to do it on. But, like, oh, it's so good. It's just horror as a genre is, like, when you put a lot of money behind it, you get things like The Shining. And then when you put no money behind it, you get things like Halloween. And it follows in The Babadook.
Stitches.
Oh my god, Stitches is the funniest thing.
I love that movie.
We watched it thinking it'd be garbage halfway through.
We ended up enjoying it.
We were laughing because it's so much fun.
Oh, this got a 1-star on Netflix. Let's watch it. This is actually kind of fun.
This is a great time. The ending with the... It has to destroy the egg to kill the clown. I'm like, what is this movie? It's just... It's such a great genre. And it's the perfect... It's a genre that keeps on giving, because people have built careers on horror. Like the Aquaman director built a lot of his career on Saw and a bunch of other horror movies. Mm-hmm. That's what he did things. Like
John Carpenter. Alfred Hitchcock.
Well,
Hitchcock more did suspense. Master of suspense.
Yeah, Hitchcock did Psycho, and he did. Did you do another horror film other than Psycho?
The Birds.
The Birds. That's right. I always forget about that film. It's so good though.
I wouldn't consider Shadow of a Doubt really horror, more psychological thriller.
It's a thriller, which is a fine line between thriller and horror, and it is harder to find it, perfectly honest.
Psychological horrors are great too.
Ooh, psychological horrors are my heart and soul. Like It Follows is totally psychological horror, and so is Babadook, bunch of stuff like that. But it's just such a great genre, because it's the perfect starting genre. It's the perfect genre to get you started, and it's the perfect genre to come back to when you're old and you want to do things again, like Scorsese. Who did The Shining? I'm blanking on that. Kubrick, well-established director, does a horror film. At a time when most horror films are really low budget, no money behind them, he does his high-budget masterpiece of a horror film called The Shining, which is one of the greatest films ever created. And it's such a great genre. Branching off of that, I thought it'd be fun to name our top five favorite horror films. In no particular order. It's not 1 to 5. It's what are the 5 horror films that you would say are your favorites? Would you like me to start?
Yeah.
If I was being honest, as a genre as a whole, my top five horror films sometimes flux, but I think the last few years has been pretty much the same. The Shining's one of them, as mentioned 100 times. The Shining is one of my favorite movies of all time. I love that film. I just adore it in every sense of the word. I think it's great. I think it's a lot of fun. I think it's interesting. It's got some... You can reinterpret that movie 100 ways, and you're still right. Like, Kubrick's a genius when it comes to his films, man. Kubrick's a real master at what he does. Real master of the craft. I'm trying to think of some... I thought my top five, and I'm constantly changing it. I'm pulling a me right now, and I have a name. Oh, Cabin in the Woods. I don't know why I was having trouble. Like, it's the one we're doing today.
It's on the notes, Christian.
I actually looked at the notes. What was it again? Oh, that's right. Cabin in the Woods. Cabin in the Woods, love Lord of Everything Horror. I love it. Drew Goddard, also producing it, was
Joss Whedon,
which was really cool because Joss Whedon obviously had a little bit of certain points in the movie. I'm like, Whedon wanted that. That's something he would have wanted.
That's a Whedonism.
Mm-hmm. It's great. The love of everything horror. I think that kind of encapsulates everything you love about horror. And it's got so many things to say about it. We'll discuss it more, but there's so many different ways to look at that film that it's super fascinating. Then we have to do, I'd have to say, would be Texas Chainsaw Massacre would be the third one. I've all the slashers I've ever watched, I think Texas Chainsaw Massacre I've watched the most, and I've gotten the most from. Because I just love the coloring, I love how it's done. I'm genuinely scared through the entire thing. It's really freaky, and it's really fun. It's just a great time. Alien, of course, like I've told you 100 times, I adore Alien. It's one of the greatest things ever created. It's a perfect sci-fi horror. It's amazing and entertaining. It's such a great time. And my number 5, now this one's in flux occasionally, but I would have to say my number 5 right now is The Babadook. The fifth one, which, that for a while was there, was Halloween, but when The Babadook came out, I saw The Babadook, I'm like, this is one of the coolest movies I've ever seen. Like, this is just perfect. I've watched so many others. I've rewatched it. We discussed earlier
About the monster, more about the people.
Yeah, and how many times me and you have sat there, we both have two completely separate interpretations of it. But then again, we've agreed with each other's interpretations, and then there's interpretations that we didn't even think of that I looked up online that are really fascinating. And I'm like, oh man, I didn't see that. Like, they didn't see about that, and I rewatched it. I'm like, oh, I see what you're talking about. That's super cool. I would say I honestly believe the Babadook is our generation Shining. That's our generation Shining. Yes. I've re-looked at the movie 100 times. And I've just seen something different every time.
If I remember correctly, Jennifer Kent said that she does not want to have a sequel. And I'm so happy she doesn't. Yeah. Because it works so well
It's hard, though, because it's the studio might make her, and I hope they don't. It's Australia, and every other nation other than the United States is great about their arts industry, because Australia funds their film people. France funds them. England funds them. You know what? People always argue, oh, American films are so good. No, American films are profitable.
Yes.
You want film art? You have to go overseas.
Yeah, a lot of our profits for films comes from the international market.
Mm-hmm. The international market is where the art really is. There are art. There's real art. Real artists in the United States that make film. But you have to look for them a little bit. There's certain films that are breakout hits, which are really artistically done. Like, on the topic of horror, like, It Follows is an American film. And God, that movie was... First off, my girlfriend genuinely uncomfortable for the rest of the evening. Like, she's like, I want to go to bed. I don't want to be touched. I'm just feeling really weird right now. It's a genuinely uncomfortable film. And maybe I felt really, like, just really disturbed by it. I'm like, this is really disturbing. There's just things like that, but like, man, most of the most greatest art, films as art in the world just come from other countries because they fund them. America, you need to start funding your arts.
Please, because I'm tired of going to classes and them showing films that have artistic elements and people are like, I don't like it because he was weird and avant-garde. I'm like, that's what makes it great.
Mm-hmm.
You didn't understand it.
Weird tangent. Sorry, guys.
I don't mean to come off as a snob, but you don't like it because you didn't understand it.
But yeah, but I considering that Babadook was made in Australia, I don't see them forcing them to make a sequel. I think they could probably just be one. I hope it is.
I hope so too. All right, I guess I'm up to bat then.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so this is obviously in no particular order. Let's go with the Babadook also because
It's such a great film. I love that film. It's so good.
It was a film that flew under a lot of people's radars too.
For a long time until, like, I don't know what it was that ended up putting it on a lot of people's books. It had to do something. For me, it was the trailer. It was a trailer I saw at a random movie I watched, and I'm like, oh, that looks cool.
I saw Jeremy John's review of it, and he's like, yeah, really good.
Yeah, same here.
I'm like, okay, I guess I'll check that out.
Real fast, a lot of our list is probably going to overlap, except for, like, a couple key points. Just be okay with it. Just understand that we share a lot of interests. That's why we get along.
We didn't run these past each other on our list.
When he went to discuss this with me, I told him no. We'll discuss it in the podcast. I wanted to keep it as authentic as possible. I wanted to keep without each other's influence on it as much as possible. Yes.
Next up is Psycho. That's more of a psychological thing.
Yeah, Psycho is cool, man.
Because
I love Hitchcock.
I love it a lot. The moment where Bates comes in dressed up as his mother.
Yeah.
After the mother reveal.
Yeah.
Frightening. Very frightening.
Yeah.
When you see it for the first time, like, oh my God, what is that? It's not a scary image. It's just the look on his face.
It's just the actor does such a good job nailing that kind of stare. That, like, stare that chills you to the bone and makes you uncomfortable. And you're just like, you don't feel comfortable.
There's
a
reason why Norman Bates is one of the most well-known figures in horror.
Mm-hmm. I mean, hell, the Bates Motel show is so good. And mm-hmm. it's because the main actor does a really good job being genuinely unnerving the entire time.
That, and you can't not... Or you can't talk about Psycho without talking about the shower scene.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. The shower scene, something fantastic. It's been parodied. It's been people have been inspired
homaged.
By it, homaged, parodied, just
my
everything.
First exposure to that was a reference in Looney Tunes Back in Action.
Good man. Good man. Looney drops the Hershey's chocolate into the drain.
That's what they actually used.
It was a really clever, subtle. It was very subtle too. I'm like, I get it because the Hershey's is clever.
That, and they had Robbie the Robot in there.
Yeah, that was pretty cool.
Next up would have to be probably The Shining. I really dig The Shining.
Shining's amazing, dude.
Jack Nicholson is one of my favorite actors.
Mm-hmm. I get to watch it.
I like him a lot.
In my film history class, film since the 1940s, we're on the New Hollywood era right now, and we watched Easy Rider, his first breakout role. Oh, man. It's so good. God, the movie's good.
I'm trying to think. I had another one. I'll come back to it. Nosferatu, the original one.
Okay.
I really
All right,
dig
yeah,
it.
No, I can dig that. I can dig that.
Because there are moments... Like, the moment where he opens the door to go suck the guy's blood for the first time.
Oh,
and it's
yes.
the slow
so,
open.
It's so... You're, like, just sitting there on the edge of your seat, just like, oh, no,
I watched
oh, no.
it in the dark. Like, pitch black. Everything in... Like, all the lights on my house were off.
Full screen on
my laptop.
I might watch Nosferatu tomorrow, actually, because now I'm kind of into it.
Yeah. And I'm like, oh, my God, that's unnerving.
Mm-hmm.
And then, what is my... Halloween.
Okay, yeah, that's fair.
Like I said,
Halloween was usually my top five until I saw Babadook. I'm like,
I really like it a lot.
Yeah.
Jamie Lee Curtis is great in that role. That was her big breakout role.
Uh-huh. It's a good movie, man. It is a good
it
movie.
Is.
Oh man, I actually, it's a movie so good that the remake of it by Rob Zombie was also really really good, and told an entirely different story. Entirely different story, quote unquote, but kept all the similar elements. It's really cool. I really appreciate what Rob Zombie did with the remake. I think it was really good.
That, and if it weren't for Halloween, we wouldn't have had Halloween 3 with the Silver Shamrock commercial.
That was pretty.
It's almost time, kids. The clock is ticking.
What was the without Friday the 13th? We wouldn't have Jason in space. Jason
yes.
X is the greatest thing to ever exist on this planet. God created Earth, then God created Jason X, and he's like, nah, this is how it needs to be. This is their legacy.
In space.
Jason, in space. All right, guys. Now it's time for everyone's favorite, Garbage Day.
Garbage Day!
What movie did we see again?
It's written right here. It's written right here. You cannot just say that you forgot the name of the movie when it's right freaking here.
There was a moment today where I was like, you know, I should probably start thinking about what I'm going to say about this movie. What movie did I see again? It was like that for 5 minutes. And what I do is I collect all my ticket stubs and I keep them in my wallet. And I had to go and look in my wallet to see what I had recently seen. Oh, that's right. American
this
Pastoral.
This is the weirdest movie about Obi-Wan Kenobi I've ever seen. Fun
yeah.
fact, Ewan McGregor is the director and the main actor in it. Obi-Wan Kenobi is in this movie, and that's kind of amazing.
He does a lot of waiting for trains, and I made a joke to Christian.
Yeah,
I'm like, he's doing a lot of
train
spotting
train
in this
spotting.
Movie.
I remember halfway through the film, I looked at it and was like, this is some weird Obi-Wan stuff going on here. I don't know what's going on in Obi-Wan in isolation. I don't know, Tatooine had so much, you know, foliage. Cows. Where's the blue milk? What's going on here?
This was terrible.
He just, at one point, Mario's like, just shut up, man. Let me suffer this in silence.
Okay.
Until, of course, it got really bad, and I was sitting down watching the film, and I'm telling the story because it's hilarious when you look up from my point of view. I am sitting down watching this film, and I'm hating myself, and there's this one moment, just I can't remember what it was, and I get this weird feeling. Like, you know how that feeling you get when you're sitting down and you feel like someone's about to kill you? And like that weird feeling you get, like you feel like someone's trying to kill you, like right to the side of you. And I'm like, that's weird. I'm looking to the left. I look to the right, and I see Mario with the angriest look on his face I've ever seen him give me. And he just looks me dead in the eyes and says, I could have seen Gal Gadot in lingerie, but you dragging me to this. Because if it wasn't for this movie, we would have gone and see
Keeping Up with the Joneses.
Keeping Up with the Joneses, which is probably gonna be next week, unless something else comes out, it's even worse. But he was so angry with me. He just looked at his face like, "This is all your fault." I'm like, "I'm sorry, buddy. We promise."
The thing is that this movie was a limited release, but our theater was unfortunate enough to have it showing.
Was it a limited release?
Yeah, it was limited release. That's why nobody's really talking about it. Because it was
limited.
It's
garbage.
No one's
talking about it because it's not good.
Oh, I saw some.
Except for that one guy in the theater who was just like,
oh my.
Everyone. God. Like this is a couple behind me that are just like talking. Like, oh my God, it's the greatest thing ever. And this one guy's behind it.
They were saying that?
Yeah, they're like getting really into it. I'm like,
what?
Are you high? I mean, I thought I heard them getting really into it. And I'm like, But it's just this like. Moment where the guy seems to be like, I don't know who's talking, but can you all quiet down?
He's this older gentleman, at least late 50s, early 60s, long hair.
Looks like our teacher Jubas's dad.
Oh my God, yes. And he gets up, I don't know who's talking, but could you please not talk?
Thank you.
And he sits back down, he stands up and he looks at all of us. We're not the only ones like making little side comments here and there, and we're quiet about it.
We're whispering each other's ears, except for when Mario gives me a death stare and he's like, "I could be seeing Gal Gadot in lingerie right now." I'm like, "I'm sorry."
The thing is, I couldn't even hear anybody else whispering. That's the thing.
I heard the couple, a couple rows back to the left of us whispering, and I didn't really care.
According to you, everybody was saying stuff during the movie, like they were all talking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you could hear it. I didn't care.
Because you could still hear the movie.
I could swear like people in the top row were like crapping on it, but I I couldn't tell. I could only hear people like directly behind us, which I could just swear they're like praising it. Like at the end, I remember someone saying, wow, this movie was amazing. And I'm just like.
Sarcastically? Like how I do 10 out of 10 cinematic masterpiece?
10 out of 10 cinematic masterpiece. I rate this movie 6 out of 9.
This was terrible.
Okay, we should probably get into why this is terrible, because it's an awful lot of just us making fun of it. Ian McGregor is the director of this film, and there's one thing I love about Ian McGregor. He cannot direct. This movie's direction is terrible. It makes no sense. It doesn't work. It's trying to have a...
He might not even really be terrible, but this is like his directorial debut.
But like it's one of those things to where... I can't tell what the message is because there's at one point in time it's very pro-feminism, but then it's super anti-feminism too. It's like, it's almost like it's pro. It kind of feels like it's pro-feminist message, anti-feminist movement, and I don't think like, and to where I'm kind of the same ideal. Like I'm very pro-feminist ideals, anti-feminist movement because just I don't feel the movement represents the ideals at all. But like, I feel this movie. Criticized it for all the wrong reasons. Like it really did take that kind of the meme Tumblr-esque crowd of people that like don't really exist but we all like make fun of because it's just a conglomeration of a bunch of really huge retards who like to just spew garbage on the internet. I'm gonna insult somebody there and I'm kind of proud of myself actually.
That's how he makes his living.
Yeah, that's true. That fake person. Will you calm your bunny boobs? It's that kind of conglomeration of like the main character's like ripping into this white male because he's a white male business owner who hires black people. And I'm like, but then he rips into her. He's like, yeah, I hire black people. And during the riots, you know what I didn't do? I didn't fire them. I let them back in because they were still my workers, because I understand the problems that they face in daily life. I can't relate to it, but I understand it. During the riots, what did I do? I made sure everyone went home and my business was safe. That way they had someone to return to for work. And like, I'm like, yeah, that's a pretty good thing to do. That was really big of you, especially
because this takes place in like the late 60s or and the mid 60s.
It's like middle of heck nowhere where like that ideology wasn't very popular. But I guess it was a very progressive family, but the movie was like very, well, you can be a progressive family and still be progressive. I'm like,
how far left can you be? That's what this movie was.
The problem is the movie bites its own self in the butt because it points out that you can't always do something. That there's sometimes limitations that don't allow you to fight. You can speak up always, and they always speak up, but they don't have the ability to fight. And it'd be fine if they never fought, but the movie clearly shows the father and the mother genuinely standing up for these beliefs when they have the opportunity, when they have the ability to do it and do it right. And I'm like, you're biting yourself. Your own message is undermined by your own film, because this father, at least, is a genuinely good human being who's trying his best to do the right thing.
Very charming.
And the
too.
Daughter, who's supposed to be like what we look at as like a real mover and shaker, someone who's really there for the betterment of society, kills people. And for a while, she's like, oh, you know, you have to find a way to do stuff. It's not there, you have to make opportunity. And I'm like, well, I guess that's fair. I mean, he does make opportunity when he can. Like, he mentioned there's a limit. There's only so far you can do. There's a line between general safety of yourself that you have to think about. And I'm like, that's also fair. Like, these are fair points. And I didn't like her character, but I think she had a fair argument up until she starts killing people.
Yeah.
That didn't do anything. And their point in the movie was ever mentioned they did anything wrong. She killed a small business owner because he was in a hick neighborhood. And obviously he's bad because he's in a hick neighborhood. Yes. We didn't know what his ideals were. We didn't know what his political stance was. So how could we possibly understand what she's doing if they never explain why that store? It never explains why that store. She just wants to start a revolution.
She becomes a terrorist.
Yeah, they basically paint them as terrorists because they never show the people that they're attacking. They never show them doing anything wrong. They just show them.
There's
as
a guy, he goes and he... The only thing that we see of him is he takes out his folded American flag and he puts it and raises it up the mast as he's about to open his store for business.
And then it blows up.
Mm-hmm. How dare you support your country and your freedom?
What really gets me is that I know it's kind of the movie tries to make the point that not all acts of rebellion are good, but instead of showing examples of good acts of rebellion, it's just tons of examples of bad acts of rebellion. Riots, which ultimately end up getting people hurt, nothing ever getting solved.
Exactly.
Bombs going off, which ultimately make the situation much worse. The person wants to topple the government and reinstitute a new government. And I'm like, we constantly mention how that's just a stupid idea and it'll never work. It'll never work in that day and age or in recent. It takes more than what they're doing. The movie has so many messages, but all of them are contradicting themselves to where the movie is just a giant blob of nothing. Absolutely nothing. It doesn't make any sense. None of the messages focus. And the problem with the movie that tries to say a lot is that you have to, the more you say in a film, the more you have to balance it. Things like The Shining, which I'll mention 100 times, which has so much to say, but balances it perfectly. Gets that fine line to push as much as it can, while still not making it contradict itself. There's no contradictory messages in there to make no sense. American Pastoral is the opposite. There's so much stuff in this film, and it's all contradicting itself.
Yes,
it's good to rebel, but it's not good to rebel. The feminist movement is here for good reasons, but they're not here. They're terrorists. And I'm like, it's just... You have to keep with a theme and then go with it. The more themes you have in your film, the more clunky your film is, and it just doesn't work that way.
It was horrible, and it was something I was talking to you about after we had seen it, and it's something that I still firmly believe. If you have to use violence to further your message, either there's something wrong with your ideals, or there's something wrong in charge with the people pushing the agenda. Mm-hmm. And that's... We were supposed to care that this girl had gone missing and that Ewan McGregor was looking for Dakota Fanning, who was playing his daughter.
It was...
I didn't really care because she was a terrible person.
Yeah, she was a genuinely bad human being who didn't accomplish anything more than just murder people.
Oh, I don't like that we're involved with Vietnam, so I'm going to kill innocent people.
And, like, her father's, like, the greatest...
That's going to solve things.
Her father's like, yeah, neither do I. That's why I argue against it. That's why I talk to people. That's why I try at home to grow a understanding of why it's wrong. And it's really cool because he even tells her, you know, revolutions start from home. You want a revolution, you have to start from home. You have to do it in the home area. You have to build a following. And I'm like, that makes a lot of sense. That's how revolutions are started. Martin Luther King didn't get big overnight. He started in his home area. He started talking to people, relating to people, moving things. It kind of, the one message this movie kind of keeps is that violence is never the answer. Even if it seems like it should be, it's not. And I respect that. Then, of course, there's moments where violence did solve something, which really frustrated me because it completely undermined it. But that's a whole... Mm.
Totally. Totally. The framing device for this film was so thin. Because it starts out with some guy going back to his high school reunion and he finds out that the main character had died.
And I get it.
It was stupid.
That's how the book did it. Yeah. And The Shining had... The book of The Shining had a bunch of really ridiculous nonsense happen in it. Why isn't The Shining movie good? It didn't copy it piece by piece.
Mm-hmm.
American Pastoral, if it just cut out the bits with going back to the future and just told that story from beginning to end,
it
wouldn't have been
it.
Good, but it would have been better.
Because the stuff really interrupted it.
Mm-hmm.
Then I was more intrigued by the guy that was writing the book than the main characters.
Yeah, because the guy writing the book had a pretty interesting story. We literally never see him. Like, he mentions how he's the best friend of this one character. He used to live in this area, and they were all super close. But we never see him.
Yeah.
Never see him in the flashbacks.
Never once.
I mean, it's assumed that it's post after he goes to Europe for a while to study. And like for a second there, they make you think that he doesn't know what happened. He doesn't know the events of the Vietnam War, and Marty's thing right there. I said, I swear to God, they tell me that when he was abroad, he didn't hear about the Vietnam War. I'm gonna get up and I'm gonna walk out right now, and there's nothing you can do to stop me. I'm instantly not gonna watch the rest of this movie.
This was like 20 minutes into the.
No,
film.
Not even like 15. Like,
oh, 15.
When they say, oh, I.
That's right.
Oh, you're the last person here to hear this story, and I'm like, are they? Talking about the Viet, because it sounds a lot like they're talking about the Vietnam War for a second there. I'm like, you're not gonna tell me that he doesn't know about the Vietnam War, one of America's greatest mistakes. No, that's not happening, movie. You're not. Don't you dare tell me that. Don't you dare use that as a plot device. I will get up and walk out right now. That'll be the one thing I will not stand is stupidness like that. And then of course, no, it's a story about his brother.
It was thinly veiled exposition.
Yeah, because then when you get to the story, I'm like, I kind of wish it was about the story about the guy who didn't know what happened to the American, the Vietnam War, because that way it'd be like an interesting see someone's point of view you've never heard about it before. I don't care, man. Just give me a movie that isn't garbage.
With the exception of Jennifer Connelly, almost everybody turns in a pretty good performance. Performances?
No, I disagree with you wholeheartedly.
Really?
There.
Who do you think didn't do well?
I don't think any of them did well.
Really?
I think they all felt forced. They all felt clunky. I felt Ian McGregor when he was on a lot of times. Most of the time when he was on camera, he was trying to be a director while acting. He was trying so hard to meet his own vision that he overacted everything. It was so hard to watch for me. I'm like, oh my god, you're overacting everything. And I get it. That's maybe his vision.
Actually, yeah, you know what? You're right. You're
and
right.
And like all the characters, when they were on camera with him, were trying so hard to get perfect, exactly what he wanted. It's just, it was hard to watch. It was rough on me. I'm like, none of the acting seems very interesting. None of the acting is very compelling.
I should kind of think of it. Dakota Fanning did get on my nerves a lot.
Yes, Dakota Fanning got on my nerves constantly. And
I don't really like her
I will
that
say
much.
Jennifer Connelly is the worst of them all. And she
has no personality.
I think her character and her presentation of this character is so poor it makes everyone else look good. But I'll still argue
that's what it is. It's the girl on the train thing with mm-hmm. the poor execution of the twist. But
yeah, it's a really cool brilliant twist. But the poor execution kind of ruins it. Like it's really hard to see it because of how bad the execution is.
Yeah.
But then again, the twist seems good because the execution. So the twist seems really interesting. Aside from this, I don't want to talk about the movie again. I want to forget about that movie. But American Pastoral, it's like
Jennifer Connelly is the worst actress in there, in a sea of bad actors and actresses. Like, everyone in there is
and
terrible.
And Ewan McGregor is a good actor.
There's so many good people on this movie, man. Just, they got Dakota Fanning, Jennifer Connelly, Ewan McGregor, because there's a three really good actors. Molly Parker, Valerie Curry,
Rupert
just,
Evans.
Yeah, Rupert Evans. Like, there's Uzo Abuda, which...
Uzo?
Yeah, who doesn't really do much, but I like their work. And like, these are good actors. These are pretty great A actors who turn great performances. I was shocked when I was watching. Like, this is awful. This is terrible. They're all doing terrible. I've never seen these actors do this bad. Which, of course, comes upon as... This might be the director's fault, then. Kind of his fault. It might not be... Ewan McGregor might be trying so focused on doing his performance right, they might also be kind of forgetting the other actors that he has to be in charge of.
Mm-hmm. The other thing that I noticed, and somebody else had pointed this out in another review, because I wanted to see if we were the only ones that are like, this is terrible, because I saw some guy like, oh, people don't like this because it's critiquing America, blah, 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 blah. I'm like, we live in a...
Really? Because
we live in an age where everybody's critiquing America.
Really? Because really it's not critiquing America at all. There's no critiques of America in the slightest. If anything, it's critiquing how America handles things.
Yeah.
It's critiquing the equal rights movement, which really bugged me because... Sorry. That kind of set me off a little in frustration.
Yeah. But one guy had mentioned that a lot of it feels...
Continue.
A lot of it feels like the abrupt... ending of sequences is kind of like, I guess, them trying to capture the feel of the book where like a new chapter begins. Like that one scene where Ewan McGregor goes and confronts his daughter's therapist, and then the scene just ends. Which I also want to talk about, because that frustrated me. That frustrated me.
Good man, it frustrated me too.
She should have reported his daughter, because she had mentioned that she was going to bomb places, that she was going to align herself with terrorist-level organizations that were going to destroy innocent people and innocent civilians. Okay? She knew that. She has an obligation. I don't care about doctor-patient confidentiality when something like that, when somebody's life is on the line.
Doctor-patient confidentiality only goes when trying to protect your own patient, but when the patient shows harm to others, you are then obligated by law to report it.
Oh, I didn't feel like I really needed to because this made her feel better and stuff. No,
she kills people. You are at fault for having her kill people.
You are an accomplice to murder.
And then make even worse when she's trying to hide, she gets raped. Like, everything in this movie can be blamed on that psychiatrist. It's all her fault. And he's like, oh, I did that. I don't say that. I'm like, no, say that. It is your fault. You are the one who did this. You could have stopped this. You're the one who made me sit down in this stupid hour and 40-minute movie. It's your fault.
That's another thing. This movie dragged on. It was only an hour and 40 minutes, but it was an hour longer than it needed to be.
We're sitting there, and we put this on all the social media sites when we took the picture. It's Mario... was sitting there like, this is an hour too long. I'm like, Mario, this movie's only an hour and 40 minutes. Like, it's an hour too long. It's like, it can't be an hour shorter. Any shorter, and it wouldn't be a movie. It can't be feature length. He's like, it's an hour too long! We were just yelling at each other real quick. It's hilarious.
It drags on and on and on. It felt like I was in the theater for hours.
When I sat there and thought about the movie in hindsight, I realized just how quickly paced everything is. Just go and go and go and go and go and go and go. I'm like, why?
Not very good at all. Do not see this. We do not recommend it. Not even for anything comedic.
No, it's complete trash.
The only line that I got out of there that was somewhat funny is when Jennifer Connelly goes to talk to Ewan McGregor's dad about getting married or something. And she's Christian or something, or Catholic. And he's Jewish. His family is Jewish. And she's trying to convince him why they should get married. And she brings up something about communion. And she mentions the body of Christ, the bread thing, right? Mm. And he says, no grandchild of mine is going to be eating Jesus.
Yeah. Or the bit with the glove.
Oh, my God. The glove. I wasn't expecting it to make a comeback in the way that it did. And I jokingly turned... Okay, because...
There's a moment with a glove where this one character is trying on a new glove. Can't remember which actress this is. I can't remember.
Yeah.
And putting it on, he's like, no, no. Like, but the like, no, 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 no. Slow the first time. And then make a fist.
Stretches out.
Stretches out. And I'm looking at Mario going like, dude,
this is really uncomfortable right now. Do you want to touch it?
Do you want to touch it? Slowly the first time.
But there's a moment where that same character. Stretch it out. There's,
like, no.
No. Then there's a moment where that same character, who apparently has information about the whereabouts.
Hillary's arrest. Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry, memes.
The whereabouts of Ewan McGregor's daughter. She lures him to a hotel room and tries to seduce him. And I lean over slowly the first time. And then she uses it! She says it! And I'm like, oh my god.
The movie makes fun of itself right then and there. I'm like, movie?
What are you doing?
Movie.
You know what you did.
Movie. This movie's trash. Don't see it, guys.
No.
I'm going to do you that favor. Don't go see it. You know how it ends? Main character dies.
That did happen.
Main character dies. It's the movie begins and the movie ends. Main character's dead.
That did happen, didn't
That's
it?
Stupid. I hate that. I hate this film so much. All right, guys. Now we're going to get on to something that I like a little better. The Rewind. The Rewind, for those of you who are unaware, is when we sit down and discuss... Sorry, I got to come out there. We sit down and we discuss a movie that was either wasn't very good at the time or was super popular at the time. We look take a look back at it and we talk about its themes. A lot of times a movie that's good at it. There's only one instance where we're going to get there where we're going to take a movie that's really bad at the time and I want to just look back at it. The movie we're going to talk about this week is The Cabin in the Woods, directed by Drew Goddard. And I think it's probably good to mention that it was also produced by Joss Whedon.
Mm-hmm.
Usually one month the producer, because the producer's just like, here's the money. Make movie. Here's the money. You can't do that because not enough money.
Sometimes they have a say in the way that the film turns out.
When your producer is a director, they're helping
to make a say in what they're investing in.
Yeah, like most of the time when producers don't direct, so they don't really know, they don't understand how like the industry works, so they're just going to trust what the director's doing. But when your producer is a really talented director like Joss Whedon, or in just case of Justice League, it's going to be Ben Affleck, who's a very talented director.
Mm-hmm.
There's going to be a level of they have a lot of control because they control the money. Now, Cabin in the Woods is a weird horror film.
It is.
As in, it's not scary in the slightest. God, does it capture... She keeps an eye on the audio, and she just has this look of, it's not scary, huh? Not scary. There's moments in this movie. But the film does this great thing. It's the greatest movie to appreciate everything horror. Everything horror is in it. Now, of course, there's going to be spoilers for this movie. It's been out for so long. Get over yourself. You should have already seen it by now. The cool thing Cabin in the Woods does is that it loves horror. The director loves horror. The producer loves horror. The actors love horror. So what does it do? Every piece of this film is an homage to something horror in some way at some point in time.
It takes the tropes and runs with them.
Like, the main characters are Scooby and the gang.
Oh, totally.
They're literally Scooby and the gang. If Scooby was a human, wanted to bone. Didn't want to have sex with anybody. That's right.
Yeah.
That was cool.
Are you saying that Scooby's the virgin?
No. Okay, that's a whole other thing. All right, I guess we should... I guess we want to start from the top down with this film.
I don't know why this is so funny.
We're waiting. No, take your time. Keep laughing.
You know what?
So I guess starting from the top down, the first thing I think we should discuss is why it's such a perfect homage. What makes it such a good homage? And I think it's because it is in its entirety. Can you stop?
Go ahead.
I can't. It's kind of distracting with you right now.
My cheeks hurt.
It's a really good homage because the film is set up as a bunch of kids go in the cabin in the woods alone for vacation. And ooh, there's monsters there.
Ooh.
But in the background, the cabin, like, the whole, like, convoluted way they get there, but it's, like, purposely convoluted. It is incredibly convoluted, but it has a reason behind it. There's a reason why it's so convoluted. It's trying to make a point. of just how convoluted horror is and super cool. It, while they're there, there's like this underground facility of people trying to make, I guess the way they put it, is the perfect horror movie to appease the gods so the world doesn't end. The movie's actually saying something about that. Now I'm gonna get, when we get into what the movie's actually saying. So what makes it such a great homage is that they show screens of things like, there's one screen has an appreciation to a Japanese and Asian horror,
mm-hmm.
with the kids trying to defeat the black haired monster, which of course is a reference to like the grunge and the ring and stuff like that. But it, like, how the way it look and how it acts is very much like how Asian horror is. I'm saying Japanese horror because it's usually Japan that makes these really great horror films.
Oh, totally.
There's one where you get a glimpse of like Germany, and it's this really dark, dirty, grungy, bloody kind of looking thing. And it's really gross and creepy and just ugly. And like, that's German horror. That is God. That's
no
German
doubt
horror.
About it.
That is a German horror film to its entirety. And the movie is based about American horror films and the American horror movies. And it's really cool because it gets us down perfectly. On the select, like, there's a handful of things it could be. And it's zombies, a slasher, ghosts. And every single one of it is something that an American audience loves in their horror films.
Mm-hmm.
What did it end up being, the one that ended up winning out? Was it like Undead Hillbillies?
I think so.
Which is like, it's kind of like a Tucker and Dale versus Evil in a lot of ways, like what they're talking about. But it's sort of an homage to like Cabin in the Woods. What's it called? Texas Chainsaw Massacre. The Undead Hillbillies is like one of the chainsaw, and it's super cool. But it's ridiculous, and people are taking bets on who's gonna win. It's sort of like when you're going to a theater and you're like, oh, who's gonna die first? And each character is meant to represent a trope. And each one is supposed to die in a particular order, and the order they die in is the order they would usually die in the movies. So this is the athlete, the scholar,
the whore,
the virgin,
and the fool.
And the fool. And they're all supposed to die in a particular way. Only look at the come down that the fool and what was it? The fool and the virgin, I think it was?
Yeah.
Don't die.
Well, the virgins, like, they can, or, you know, they have the potential to die, but sometimes the majority of the time they'll just end up living.
Uh-huh. But what's really cool about it is that the fool, with the virgin's help, choose not to die, which is fascinating. There's this whole fascinating thing about how it sets up, it takes the tropes of horror, the tropes, it makes it a plot device, and it's really, really cool how well done it is. There's like this moment when they go down to the facility and they let out the monsters. And
oh,
like,
that's the best part.
Every single monster is a monster at some horror movie. There's a moment where you get to see all the boxes that they're in. And if you right there, I could sit there for an hour. Like, I know what that's from this movie. That's from this movie. That's from this movie. Look very closely. You can kind of see someone who looks like the movie Teeth. The one without the killer vagina.
Yeah.
The movie's disgusting. It makes me uncomfortable. But it's super cool because it's like, oh my god, I know that reference. That's such a like very underrated, not talked about reference. Like, that's really taking it from there. And there's things in there I don't recognize, but most of them I recognize. I'm like, oh, I get that. That's from this deal. Dude, there's a leprechaun in there.
Yeah.
From, what was that movie? The movie with the killer leprechaun was called. I never remember what it's called. It was stupid.
Leprechaun?
Was it called Leprechaun? Just called Leprechaun? Oh, okay. And it's super cool. It's a really great homage. It's got little great themes to it. It takes every theme of horror and it represents it in a different way. Having people in charge of the facility, like their producers and studio, and this people from the producers in the studio who are like kind of taking bets on how it's gonna go, how the director's gonna make it in some weird way. And like the gods are us, people who consume
the viewers.
Yeah, the viewers were the ones who ultimately say whether it's good or bad. I'll get into that in a second. It's really cool how it just shows its appreciation of horror as an industry, and it's really fascinating. And now I think it's part of what I was excited for is the different themes this movie has, because this movie has a particular thing in it that I adore. But I'm gonna let Mario go ahead. He looks like he's been wanting to say something.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
It has the best line written for any film ever.
Didn't go places I want to hear, but go ahead. Didn't go places I didn't expect, sorry. Go ahead.
Tequila is my lady.
Tequila is my lady. My God, I love him so much. My favorite is when the guy is on the motorcycle. He tries to go off the ramp to go on the other side of the street. Hits the wall. Most satisfying splat sound I've ever heard.
Splat.
Punk. I'm like, oh my God, this movie branched to comedy. I love this film. First time I watched this, I saw it with my friend Cody, my friend Speedy. And right when that happened, we replayed it 4 times because it was so freaking funny. We laughed so hard. It was like we kept replaying it because the sound killed us.
I really dig it for the same reason that I really dig Rubber. And I know a lot of people hate Rubber. And it's a stupid movie. It is a very stupid movie.
Boring.
But I like it for its commentary on audiences.
Okay.
And that's what this movie essentially is. There's a bit where one of the characters starts to do some dirty things. And they're like, oh, we need to have a little bit of boobage right here. And bingo. The crowds really like that.
Mm-hmm. The people that are in charge of in the facility are very much like the producers and the studios, because they're meeting quotas. They're trying to meet certain quotas, and they're watching these things happen. They're trying to check the boxes and like, oh, we need boobage, we need this, we need that, we need whatever. Oh, people like this. They're constantly talking as if they're studio representatives, and it's really interesting. What I love is the commentary about originality in horror.
Yeah.
And why horror films aren't original. So, like we said before, a lot of the movie is showing, like, the characters in this film are like the characters in any horror film. The people in the, like, facility or the studios and whatnot, and the gods that they're afraid of are us. What's cool about it is that to appease the gods, the movies have to go down in a specific way. If they don't go down in a specific way, the gods aren't pleased, thus destroying the world.
Yes.
What's super cool about that is that it's a commentary on how we treat horror. If the horror movie isn't good, we end the franchise because we don't like it. We'll complain and complain about how, oh, this ain't good. This doesn't follow my standards of horror at all.
Which are typically garbage.
Yeah, and like the most of the time it's like, I like Paranormal Activity. But we just needed one. We didn't need the every subsequent sequel of Paranormal Activity was awful and didn't need to happen. I love the first one. I'll wholeheartedly fight it. That movie was excellent. But, you know, like, seems like Friday the 13th and Jason and Friday the 13th, Nightmare on Elm Street, Texas Chainsaw Massacre. These are movies that got sequels because the first one was really good and they just kept pumping out sequels. And how Cabin in the Woods explains is as if we are gods to that universe, because if we do not like that movie, we essentially destroy their world. Mm-hmm. We are their gods. Yeah. And it's fascinating how it says that they have to go through a particular set of criteria, and it doesn't mean like criteria, they destroy the world. And what I love about this film is that this commentary even is on itself, because in the end, the characters having this conversation, which is really remiss, that They're basically saying that no one's going to like this movie. People who like horror aren't going to like this movie. And it's fascinating because they're right. Because there are two types of people that come out of this movie. They're the ones who are like, wow, this is excellent. And the ones that come out like, this is stupid. This isn't a horror movie at all. I wasn't scared at all.
I don't like those kind of people.
But they're the exact ones the movie is critiquing. They're saying, you're the reason the horror genre isn't unique, isn't interesting. Because why?
Formulaic.
It's formulaic. All these other different nations that have all the different films and their styles, they'll end differently. Mm-hmm. You know, not everyone dies in the end. You know, the movie either ends happily or it comes up with this really different way or unique way of ending it. Like the kids are chanting, joining together chanting to get rid of the monster. And I find that so fascinating. And like, it's commentary on it's not horror as a genre, it's American audiences saying that it doesn't work with us. Because we expect something certain to come out of it, and it's our expectations which ultimately leads to why these films are constantly pumped out year after year. Because remember, they mentioned the film, and they're doing this every single year.
Mm-hmm.
Every single year,
Halloween
around time. The same time, Now, it's never said it's around Halloween in the film.
Well, no, like in our world.
Yeah, it's around Halloween.
It's around Halloween time.
And the one, if they mess up 1 year, their world is destroyed. So it's like the producers are trying to create this film in this like world, and what they're hoping to do is that by creating it, they can keep it alive and keep their world alive. And that's just this whole commentary about American audiences and how we're so picky and we're not willing to accept change or anything different. Things have to be a certain way of done. And it's so cool because it's not just subtle, it's shoving it down your throat. And it's like, movie is saying that if you don't like this film, it's because it doesn't meet your standards of horror. Which for most films I'll get mad at because if I don't like it because it's not good. But in this one, I like it because it's well done. It makes sense. Yes, this is a good movie. People who don't like this film that's the reason why. It doesn't meet their criteria.
Mm-hmm.
There's also the whole thing about it explains how stupid the formula is. Now it doesn't make any sense at all.
Yeah, no, it doesn't
make sense. It's just people don't act like that. Like at one point, the characters point out how wrong it is that this is the formula because people aren't these stereotypes. People don't fall into these stereotypes. The characters even mentioned, like toward the end, the characters mentioned that there was more to those people than just those particular tropes. They broke them down to the very basic characterizations, and it was just,
or even transformed some of them.
Yeah, and like it's just kind of critique of like, you know, these basic stereotypes of a character, it's boring. It's boring and stupid, and why would you want that? And it asks the question, because what they say is that if this is what it takes to save this world, is the world worth saving? What I found interesting is that's the movie basically saying that if this is what we have to do to keep the horror genre alive, is the horror genre even worth it? If we can't be creative in a genre like this, if we can't have creativity in this genre, is the genre worth keeping? And I'm like, that's such a interesting question to ask in a film. It's a film asking whether it should exist, whether its existence is not ultimately pointless. I'm like, that's awesome. That's super, super fascinating.
I like it a lot.
I love this movie.
It's funny. It's thought-provoking. It's well shot, well directed.
I guess people who don't like this film, I always ask them, just go back, stop, and I want you to look at the movie like this. Look back at the movie and ask yourself, when watching the film, how much of this is just bad? Or how much of this is just because I'm not used to this in this type of movie?
What you do is you set them down and say, look, I want you to find 5 movies where a group of characters go out to a cabin somewhere in the woods.
Or go alone in the woods or alone.
And tell me you do not see these tropes.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are people that actually like, oh yeah, the black guy always dies first. And they're not even really well-versed in film. And they're like, they see these tropes. But they don't admit that there's a problem with the formula.
Yeah, like people are like, oh, this is just a fun trope. I'm like, actually, no, to be fair, the whole black guy at first is incredibly racist and incredibly frustrating. The whole, oh, the virgin has to live, is incredibly sexist. And really, it's usually screwed always up.
A girl.
It's always a girl. And it's always a super pretty girl who's so great because she hasn't had sex before marriage. And look at her all...
And I want to say it really starts with Halloween because Jamie Lee Curtis is a virgin in the movie and she's the only one that doesn't get axed.
Yeah. I think it's also on Friday the 13th as well.
Yeah.
It's not in Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
It's not a new thing. It's been around for a while.
Texas Chainsaw Massacre, like one person survives and it's the horror. Well, one of the horrors. I like this film.
Yeah, I like it a lot, too. I need it on Blu-ray.
And it's cool because you just got to sit and say, look, just look at the film and ask yourself this. Where have I seen that before? And if you can sit down and watch Cabin in the Woods, try to look at it through the perspective of, okay, it's a horror movie not meant to scare me, but meant to make me think. So what does it want me to think about? And if you can sit there and just, I don't like the message, I can respect that.
Yeah.
I can understand that because the message is very anti, it's the anti-film goer. It's anti-people. Movie is fighting you.
That though because it's meta.
Yeah,
and I love meta.
I guess another example is Funny Games, the original Funny Games. If you haven't seen it, God, you have to see it. It's if you are a film
it's an experience.
If you're a film appreciate, go watch Funny Games, because Funny Games does the same. Funny Games is the precursor to The Cabin in the Woods. That movie is a huge. It's a not German film.
It's German.
No, it's Austrian.
It's Austrian?
It's Austrian.
Oh, okay.
It's an Austrian film that's critiquing the horror genre. Not just horror genre, but violence in film. But it uses horror as an element. And it's really, really, really cool, because it reminds me a lot of Cabin in the Woods. It's very similar in the idea of that. It makes you sit down and look at yourself honestly and ask yourself, okay, you like this film, you like these movies, but have you ever actually sat down and think how messed up it is? Like in Funny mm-hmm. Games, there's a moment where it's like it gives you the violence, you finally get the violence that you want, that kind of just build up in the violence you finally want, but it then makes you sit down and makes you feel every ounce of crappy that someone would feel after a kid dies. And it makes you uncomfortable. It makes you just...
It's like a 13-minute uncut take.
13-minute uncut take where nothing happens and you're forced to watch real, genuine emotion pour out. Something you don't get in after someone dies. You don't get that genuine emotion. You get the fake emotion. But this was genuine emotion you're being forced to feel, and it makes you feel uncomfortable and unnerving. Cabin in the Woods is a lot like that. Cabin in the Woods makes you frustrated because of it makes you look at the tropes honestly, and that's what frustrates you, because like it makes you hate the tropes that you're so used to, and it makes you ask the question, are these tropes worth it?
See, the thing I really dig about it though is it takes the window and turns it into a mirror.
Yeah, and it's so cool. I
love that so much, because you can go into the film and turn your mind off, mm-hmm. and that's fine. Everybody needs a little bit of escapism every now and then, but
Cabin in the Woods forces you to look at yourself.
Yes, because
it forces you to reevaluate how you look at horror.
Audience reactions and the reception that a film gets, both financially and critically, determines how films will be produced in the long run.
Yeah,
the success of the Dark Knight trilogy led to the dark and gritty take on the DC films. Now,
I hate it because the Dark Knight trilogy was so good.
The fun take on the Spider-Man films led to a more lighthearted Marvel film series. Mm-hmm. And people refuse to admit or really realize that our reception and reactions to these things, whether we critically praise them or pan them, influences how films are going to be released and made in the future.
I would argue that, and the film points out too, that we as an audience like to see it from one side of the equation. Now it's just the studio's not understanding what made the movie good. And I'm like, okay, well, how can they understand when they make money off the same formula over and over again?
They're just looking at the numbers.
They're going to start picking it up that this is the formula that sells. Like, the Cabin in the Woods does point out, yes, it's because it always works. But then it asks, well, why does it always work? Why do they always do it? Why would they do it if they didn't make money off of it? And it just sits there and it's like, it makes you honestly rethink, like, okay, maybe it is my fault. But that's when we have to look at yourself and face your own criticism inside yourself. And then you're like, oh, wow, yeah, I'm a jerk, aren't I?
And that's why I really love both film analysis and film criticism, because it forces the person in question that has viewed a film to not absentmindedly say, oh, yeah, I liked it or I didn't like it. It forces you to actually think about why you liked it, what worked, what made it unique.
Mm-hmm.
And this movie is definitely unique because it takes everything that we're familiar with and flips it on its head.
Mm-hmm. And not only just flips it on its head, blatantly tells you every time you can, it basically tells you that if you don't like how the industry is run, it's your fault. Mm-hmm. Because you fund it. You let it happen. It blames the audience for the quality of horror films we get. It tells you that if you have a problem with it, you can fix it, but you don't want to because you kind of enjoy it. That's why a lot of people didn't like the film, and I fully believe that a lot of people didn't like the film because it made them honestly look at themselves and realize that they complain for something that they actually like.
Mm-hmm. Or they didn't understand it.
Mm-hmm. Well, everybody, that was another riveting episode of the Clutters Coalition. I am one of your hosts, Christian Bean, and with me always is one of my best buddies in the entire world, Mario Bennese. I hope you all enjoyed it. Y'all have a safe, fun, and exciting Halloween.
And remember, Scooby was a virgin.
Thank you for listening to Collectors Coalition, a Magnesium Studios production. If you like what you've heard, be sure to like us on Facebook and subscribe to us on iTunes. We're also available on PodOmatic and SoundCloud.
Be sure to follow us on Instagram, at Collectors Coalition, and on Twitter, at Collect Coalition.
Stupid character limits.
If you want to write in, drop us a line at thecollectorscoalition@gmail.com. For exclusive footage, be sure to check out our YouTube channel. Just search Collectors Coalition.
And remember, stay nerdy, my friends.